Have you ever thought about it? I mean, really, what is the purpose to life? Why are we here? Where did we come from? For that matter, where are we going to go when this life is over? In this seminar that talks about the age of the earth, Dr. Hovind gives solid evidence to show that this earth is not billions of years old. In fact, the evidence points towards a literal six-day creation, like told about in Genesis chapter 1. Hi, my name is Aaron, and we hope you enjoy this incredibly powerful seminar presented by Dr. Hovind. It's called The Age of the Earth.
All right, it's an honor to be here in Southern California tonight. How many been to one of my seminars before? Or seen a videotape? How many never have? Okay, and how many do not understand the question so far? Good guy. My name is Kent Hovind. I taught high school science for 15 years. And now I travel and do seminars on creation, evolution, and dinosaurs. And I let people know what I believe before I get started. I believe the Bible is the infallible, inspired, inerrant word of the living God. I believe it from cover to cover. Amen. And I believe the evolution theory that's being taught in our schools is one of the dumbest and most dangerous religions in the history of humanity. And those are the nice things to say about it. Okay. So, one of my jobs as a Christian, and your job if you're a Christian, is to be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh the reason of the hope that's in us. And I think in the last 200 years, the Christians have not done a good job of answering the skeptics. And we've allowed them to take over our school system and our legal process, and our whole thinking process is now based on this theory called evolution. Folks, there's a war going on, and there are three things I try to accomplish in my seminar. Number one, I want to strengthen your faith in the Word of God. Number two, if you're not saved, I'm going to try to get you converted tonight. Okay? I told you right up front, I'm after you. Right? Number three, if you're saved and you're not doing much for the Lord, then I'm going to try to make you uncomfortable. Fair enough? I need to warn you, just about every sin in the book is mentioned in my seminar series. It's likely that everybody's toes will be stepped on at least once. We recommend steel-toed shoes or a willingness to move your feet. You will need one or the other. Okay, this is not my wife. That's just a picture of her. We live in Pensacola, Florida. Been there for 15 years. I have three kids, one of each. My kids are 24, 25, and 26, a year and 2 weeks apart. It's called family planning where I come from. And let's see, my daughter Marlissa is here tonight. Where'd she go? Marlissa, she's out there somewhere. They got the stuff at the airport. I saw them here. And anyway, I got them all married off, brother, and the dog died, so I made it. I'm home free. It's wonderful. And all six of them work for me in my ministry, and now I've got two grandkids, and hopefully 1,000 more coming. Grandkids are God's reward for not killing your own kids when you thought about it. We, at our ministry, produce a lot of videotapes. We've made over 1 million videos now in 6 languages. They're not copyrighted. We encourage you to get our stuff and spread it around. It's copied all you want. We put out a lot of materials, and we want to see people get saved. We have quite an interesting ministry. I'll tell you more about that in a minute. They're in creation science evangelism. We have about 40 people on staff now, a little over 40, and we are trying to stir up trouble for the entire planet. Okay. Now, we do this because we want to change people's worldview. A worldview is the way you view the world, obviously. Now, there are two ways to view this world. Some people look at the world and say, you know, it's amazing that this came from evolution. Other people say it came from a creator. Now, the way you answer the four great questions in life is determined by how you view the world. The four fundamental questions of life, who am I, where did I come from, why am I here, and where am I going when I die, those four questions are answered very differently depending on how you view the world. Some people look at the world and say, it's amazing, a big bang made this from nothing. That's the humanist worldview based on evolution. Other people look at the world and say, you know, there's incredible design, there must be a designer, and that's called the creationist worldview. And those two worldviews are polar opposite. I mean, somebody's wrong, okay? And they are at war with each other. And I enjoy showing them who's wrong. So that's what I do. I go around and do a lot of debates at universities. I've had 87 now, debates at universities. I had 3 in the last 2 weeks. Can't find any more opponents, though. So if you believe in evolution, you want to debate on the topic, call me. I'll be glad to come do it. Okay? Now, if the evolution theory is true, how would you answer the four fundamental questions of life? Who am I, and what am I worth? Well, if evolution is true, you are nothing important. You're just a bit of protoplasm that washed up on the beach. You're not worth a thing. Actually, you're part of the problem because you're one of the polluters of the environment. And the more of you we can get rid of, the better. Where'd that come from? Now, if evolution is true, we came from a cosmic burp about 20 billion years ago. Why am I here? What's the purpose of life? Well, if evolution is true, there is no purpose, so you might as well have fun. If it feels good, do it. Where am I going when I die? Well, if evolution is true, we're going to the grave and we're going to get recycled into a worm or a plant. But see, the Bible says, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Now, if that's true, that puts a whole different set of answers to those questions. That means we better try to figure out who God is and find out what he wants and do what he says. Because he owns this place, folks. He makes the rules. It belongs to him. But the devil doesn't like that. The devil came to Eve in the Garden of Eden. He said to the woman, "Yea, hath God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden?" Question mark. The first sentence out of the devil's mouth was a question to make Eve doubt God's word. And he's still doing the same thing today. He wants you to doubt God's word. I think that's one of the reasons why there's so much confusion about all the different Bible versions. Oh, where is God's word? Same old trick from the devil. Second thing he said to the woman, he said, "Ye shall not surely die." Now he's denying God's word, and he does that still today. But the third thing he said is what I want to talk to you about tonight. He said, "Eve, if you eat off that tree, ye shall be as gods." And right there is where the whole idea of evolution got started. It didn't start with Charlie Darwin. It started with Satan in the Garden of Eden. He wants you to think you can become a god. Yes, boys and girls, we started off like an amoeba, and we're evolving. We're getting bigger and better and stronger and smarter, and someday we're going to sail around the universe and discover new life forms like Star Trek. People ask me all the time, they say, "Hovind, do you think there's intelligent life on other planets?" I say, "Nope. I taught high school 15 years. There's not much intelligent life on this planet." Satan's a liar. He said, "You can be like God." Well, I tell you what, the Mormon church has swallowed that one, haven't they? They teach their people, if you're a good Mormon, you get to be God someday. And if you're a good Mormon wife, when you go to heaven, you get to be eternally pregnant, producing spirit babies. My wife don't want to go. She said, "That's not heaven, honey." By the way, there are some great books to reach Mormons, and they need the gospel just like everybody else. There's a good website, UTLM, for UtahLighthouseMission.org, if you have everything you want to know about Mormons. I was surprised to find out a couple years ago, some of the major Catholic theologians of the past have taught man can become God. Now, most Catholics don't believe that. They don't even know some of their leaders have taught that. The idea that man can be God came from the devil in the Garden of Eden. He's the one who wants to be God. Lucifer said, "I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High." See, the devil wants to be God, but the job is not available. So he's all upset about that, and he can't be God. So he's mad at God, but he can't do anything to God. So he's mad at us because we are made in God's image. Did you ever wonder why the devil hates you so bad? It's because you remind him of God. So he lied to Eve and told her she could be like God. Now, Hitler said, if you tell a lie long enough and loud enough and often enough, the people will believe it. He said they're more likely to believe a big lie than a small one. Now, if you want to get somebody to believe a lie, you have to do it like my two big brothers did with me. I have two older brothers. They've always been older than I am. But when I was about 6 years old, I was raised in East Peoria, Illinois. And I came running in for breakfast one morning, and I was the first one there for breakfast. And I got the last banana out of the bowl to put on my cereal. Well, a few minutes later, my two big brothers came in, and they said, "Hey, Kent, is that the last banana?" I said, "Yep," and I got it. How many of you have an older brother or sister? You know that wonderful feeling you get when you finally pull one over on them? They pick on you all the time. Boy, that morning I had them, and I knew it. They wanted my banana. But big brothers do not beg little brothers for anything. They either beat them up and take it away by brute force, or they lie to them and trick them out of it somehow. So my brothers said, "Hey, Kent, do you know how bananas are made?" I said, "No. I was only 6 years old. It's been proven in laboratory tests the brain doesn't even start to grow till kids are 18 to 20. How many parents can verify that one from raising kids? I said, I said, no, how are bananas made? And they said, well, down in South America, they have these spiders that live up in the trees. And when they die, all their legs fold up, and then mold begins to grow on the dead spider legs. And a banana is nothing but moldy spider legs. I said, you guys are lying to me. You just want this banana because you know it's the last one. They said, no, brother, we're not lying. You cut that thing in half and look in the middle. You can still see the black spots where his legs were. You know, I did not eat bananas for nearly 3 years after that. They lied to me. Have you ever been lied to before? You know, I would not have believed a lie if it hadn't been for those black spots. You see, if you want to get somebody to believe a lie, you have to mix it in with some truth. That's a technique they've used for years to kill rats. They mix two things together that really don't belong together. They have mixed together in that box good food and rat poison. Actually, a lot of folks don't realize, but rat poison is 99.995% good food. There's very little poison in rat poison. But by mixing them together, the rat thinks he's getting free food. Well, yes, but he's getting poisoned. It's the same technique they use to sell Marlboro cigarettes. For years, they've been mixing them in with cowboys. Watch any Marlboro commercial. There's something about a cowboy in there someplace, right? Have you ever thought about that? What is the connection between smoking Marlboro and cowboys? Do all cowboys smoke Marlboro? No. Do you have to smoke Marlboro to be a cowboy? No. If you start smoking Marlboro, do you become a cowboy automatically? No. You may smell like a horse, but you are not a cowboy. Okay? Actually, it's been proven in laboratory tests that nobody in the world smokes. Nobody smokes. Only the cigarette smokes. The person is the sucker. That's all. I think they ought to put the real name on those things. They ought to call them cancerettes, breath rotters, bypass, malignant, phlegm balls, and money suckers. Mm-hmm. There we go. They do the same thing with beer, though. They always try to associate beer with sports. What does beer have to do with sports? They get some big old football player holding his can of Bud Dumber. Or Bud Stupid. They call it Bud Wiser. It don't make him any wiser, that's for sure. He's got his Bud Dumber, Miller Lowlife, or Dead Dog. Well, he says, man, you drink this stuff, you'll be a football player. Yeah, right. Bible says, you drink that stuff, you will wreck your life. Who hath woe? They that tarry long at the wine. The Bible says, don't even look at it when it gets fermented. Habakkuk said, woe to him who giveth his neighbor drink. The Bible has a lot to say about this topic. One kid said, what's the matter, Brother Hovind? Don't you like beer? I said, I don't know. I've never tasted it. I'm 51 years old, never had a drop in my life. Well, I had NyQuil a couple times. And he said, how do you know you won't like it if you don't try it? I said, son, that's a brilliant way to live. Now, let me ask you a question. Have you ever laid your head under a semi-truck? How do you know you won't like it if you don't try it? Okay? You don't have to try everything to figure out if it's good or bad, okay? There's other ways to learn. But this mixing of the good and the bad together is exactly what's going on in our science books. Now, folks, I'm not against science. I like science. Matter of fact, we have a science center and Dinosaur Adventureland, my backyard. 5.5 acres of the coolest place on planet Earth. Right next to Pensacola Christian Academy, right behind where they produce the Becca books. Some of the kids are telling me they use the Becca books. That's where, right behind them. We've had 30,000 visitors in the first 2.5 years. Everything has a science lesson and a spiritual lesson. We have just some amazing things going on there. We can try our climbing wall or see our 7-foot snake. He ate a kid last week, but oh well. Bacteria model and all kinds of dozens of skins and skulls of animals. If you have any of those things, send them. We'll put them on display. One of our guys shot a T-Rex. We hung it on the front of the building. We like science. We're not against science. Everything has all these cool science lessons. We have a seven-level cave crawler. You can try to crawl in there. Some kids are still in there from a week ago. We can't find them. Our leap of faith swing off the 16-foot tower. Parents say, isn't that dangerous? We say, well, yeah, but there's a lot of kids, and they're always making more. So, you can measure your horsepower. If you think you're in pretty good shape, come on out. See how many horsepower you are. We have all kinds of cool dinosaur stuff every place around. Well, Dinosaur Adventureland. What do you expect, you know? We've had people from all over. God's given us an amazing staff. We like science, folks. We're not against science. We dig for fossils, and different people support our ministry from time to time. And we have all kinds of homeschool classes on video or DVD. If you want our homeschool classes, teaching all kinds of things. Okay, we do all this. We even have a creation boot camp coming up. Every September, we have a boot camp. If you want to come get booted, or whatever they do, a boot camp. September, we teach you how to be a better creation scientist and how to get out and speak on creation. We're going to train some more leaders there this September. We're not against science. We even teach the kids the scientific way to shoot a rubber band. I need two volunteers here, a boy and a girl. There's a boy right there and a girl right there. Come on up here. Let's go. Come on. Hurry, hurry, hurry. Daylight's burning. Let's go. Okay, now what's your name?
Ashley.
Ashley? Is this your husband here? No. What's your name?
Steven.
Steven? Pick out a rubber band. The red one and the yellow one. So I'll get a blue one so we can tell who's shooting the different ones, okay? They're all the same, though. Okay, ladies first. Ashley, see how far you can shoot it out there toward the back? Now, you want to let go of the end that's closest to you. Oh, that's not blonde. That's not blonde. Never mind. Okay, go ahead. Oh, about six rows back. Okay, Stephen? Where'd his land? About the same place. Now, I happen to know the scientific way to shoot a rubber band. Are you ready for this? You see the guys in the sound booth back there? Hey, did it make it into the sound booth back there? Oh, right, hit the wall right in front of it. Okay. Now, right about now, you're thinking of a question that has five words in it. See? See? How did you do that? Okay. Now, first of all, I need to let you know that I am fully aware of the fact that some kids should not learn how to do some things. Who's responsible for this one here? Is she safe with this information? Okay. Now, this one I'm really worried about just from looking at him. Who's responsible for this guy right here? Is he safe with this information? Not. Oh, what does she know that I don't know? Okay, now I want you to notice my fingers do not leave my hand at any time when I do this, okay? That's important, okay? There are two sides to the rubber band. You with me so far?
Yeah.
Okay. One side represents your flesh, that's your body. The other side is your spirit. Now your flesh and your spirit have to work together or else you're dead. See, if your spirit ever leaves your flesh, you got a real problem on your hands. Actually, the neighbors do, but okay. Now, here's what most people do wrong with rubber band shooting and in real life. They put the same emphasis on the flesh and the spirit. And when they let it fly through the air, if you could watch it in slow motion, the flesh and the spirit are fighting with each other all the way. So all the energy is wasted on internal turbulence within the rubber band. It doesn't go very far. So the secret to high-speed velocity through a fluid medium, such as the atmosphere, which offers resistance, is to minimize or eliminate the turbulence. If you want it to go farther, you put more emphasis on the spirit and less on the flesh. I'm going to stretch this side tighter. Feel it. One side's tight, one side's loose. So if you let it go quickly, it'll spin through the air. The spirit leads the flesh. Less turbulence, greater distance. So if you really want to go far for the Lord, quit putting so much emphasis on the flesh. It's real simple. Now watch this carefully. Those people coming in late, we're going to nail them. Almost got it. Let's give them a big hand. Thank you, thank you. Have a seat. That's just one of about 80 science lessons we teach the kids at Dinosaur Adventure Land, along with a good spiritual lesson. The flesh lusteth against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh. They are contrary one to the other. We also teach the kids how to make a paper airplane that'll fly over 400 feet. Our record is 450 feet with a paper airplane. They go so far that if they don't land on a building or in a tree, they go all the way to the ground. It's amazing, brother. You can go on our website, drdino.com, and see how to make those. Folks, we're not against science. We like science. But I'm against the poison mixed in our science books. That's what's bothering me. Here's a first grade textbook. Look what they tell the kids in first grade. Boys and girls, Earth has changed much since its formation 4.5 billion years ago. Now just hold on a minute. Is the Earth 4.5 billion years old? No, but if you tell that to a first grader, he's going to believe you. First graders believe everything you tell them. They believe bananas are moldy spider legs. I did, okay. And then tell them again in second grade. Since its formation 4.5 billion years ago, Earth has changed. Down here it says, life too has evolved on Earth. This word evolved is a very tricky word. There are six different meanings to the word, okay? So I've done 87 debates and over, I think, 7,000 now radio and TV call-in talk shows. I've learned how to win the debate on evolution in the first 5 minutes. It is so easy. If somebody says, do you believe in evolution? I simply say, what do you mean? Well, you know, evolution. Oh, no, I don't know. What do you mean? Which meaning are you talking about? Are you talking about cosmic evolution, that is the origin of time, space, and matter, the Big Bang? No, I don't believe in that. Are we talking about chemical evolution? Because according to the Big Bang theory, the Big Bang made hydrogen. Okay, then how did we get these other elements? Do you want me to believe that uranium evolved from hydrogen? They'll say, well, yeah, in stars, you get fusion. Well, you can't fuse past iron. Check it out. So how do we get uranium? Huh? You want me to believe in stellar and planetary evolution, that the stars and planets form? Nobody's ever seen a star form. We see stars blow up all the time. It's called a nova or a supernova if it's a big one, but we've never seen one form. And yet there's enough stars out there right now that we know about that everybody on planet Earth can individually, personally own 11 trillion of these stars to yourself. Those are the ones we know about. We don't know about the ones that we don't know about. Then there'd have to be organic evolution. That's the origin of life. Nobody has a clue how life can get started from non-living material. Do you want me to believe that living things came from... You want me to believe in spontaneous generation proven wrong 200 years ago? No, I don't believe in any of those four. Maybe you're talking about macroevolution. That's where an animal changes into a different kind of animal. Nobody's ever seen that. Nobody's ever seen a dog produce a non-dog. I mean, you may get a big dog or a little dog, I understand, but you're going to get a dog, okay? Every time. And it could be the dog, the wolf, and the coyote had a common ancestor. I wouldn't argue about that. But I'll tell you what, every little kid knows they're the same kind of animal. I'll show you. Is anybody in here 5 or 6 years old? Who's 5 or 6? How old are you? 6. What's your name? Rachel? Rachel, why don't you take a test here, Rachel? Here we have a dog, a wolf, a coyote, and a banana. Which one is not like the others? The banana, very good. Let's give her a hand. All right. Amen. We have college professors can't figure that one out. Yeah. See, the Bible says they bring forth after their kind. See, if they can bring forth, they're the same kind. Simple definition. Can they bring forth? A dog and a wolf can mate and bring forth. A dog and a banana cannot. Now, see, Charlie Darwin wrote a book called The Origin of Species. And how the Christian church got lost in the 1800s and didn't catch that, I don't know. But they didn't catch what's happening. They're changing the definition. If they'd have stuck with the word kind, we never would have had this dumb evolution theory permeating our society. They bring forth, they're the same kind. Anyway, lastly, we have what's called microevolution. This is variations within the kinds. Ah, now this one happens. So if you want to talk about variations, I agree, they happen. That is actually science. The first 5 meanings of the word are purely religious. So I'm telling you folks, if you're going to get into a discussion on evolution, you better define what you're talking about, or you'll never get any place. Because when I say the word evolution, I'm thinking of these 5 up here, but when the atheist says the word evolution, he's thinking of number 6. And he doesn't understand how I can't see it, and I don't understand how he does see it, because we haven't defined the terms. That's the problem. Anyway, the teachers are told in their teacher's manuals, be sure to stress that the earth is billions of years old. Make sure the kids believe this. Now, I happen to be a little old-fashioned. I think in science class, we should be teaching science. You know, things we can observe and study and test and demonstrate. Science. Things like the first law of thermodynamics, which tells us matter cannot be created or destroyed. Well, everything's made out of matter, so if matter cannot be created or destroyed, then how did the world get here? We're here, you know. So that leaves 2 choices. Somebody made the world, or the world made itself. There's no other choice. Well, there are a few out there on the lunatic fringe who will tell you, we're not really here at all, we just think we're here. Okay, well, you can forget about those folks. We're here, okay? So either somebody made the world like the Bible says, God did it, or the world made itself like the humanists believe. Well, if the world just made itself, how could this happen? Oh, the devil thought about that for a long time. And finally, one day, he came up with the Big Bang Theory. How many have ever heard of the Big Bang Theory? I was on the airplane years ago, flying from Dallas to San Francisco, the land of the fruits and the flakes. And I happened to sit right next to a professor from Berkeley, UCal Berkeley. I don't know if you folks down here have ever heard of Berkeley or not, but Berkeley is not a Bible college. I got to speak last year at Berkeley for 10 hours, the most hostile audience I've ever had in my life. It was so fun. It was a blast, brother. I'm doing it again in April, two more months. Berkeley, yay, bring them on. 138 professors refused to debate me. So I'll just go straighten them out by myself. Okay. The guys are a lot smarter than I am, but I slaughter them because I'm right, they're wrong. Okay. You know, would you want to defend the idea that we all came from a rock? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Anyway, I'm sitting on the airplane right next to this professor from Berkeley, and we started talking about creation and evolution. Everybody I sit by on the airplane wants to talk about that, so I talk about it with him. He said he believed in evolution. I said, yes, sir, I figured that. You have to teach at Berkeley. I said, tell me, sir, if you believe in evolution, how did the world get here? He said, oh, it came from the Big Bang. I said, really? I'd like to hear about this. He said, you're a science teacher and you've never heard of the Big Bang? I said, oh, yes, sir, I've heard a lot about the Big Bang. And I believe in the Big Bang, but my Big Bang's a lot different than yours. I said, you tell me about your Big Bang, and then I'll tell you about my Big Bang. And so the professor went off on one of those answers. It looked like it came straight from the textbook. He said, well, Hovind, I believe about 18 or 20 billion years ago, that's a long time, all the matter in the universe. Now, that's a lot of stuff. Hey, by the way, did you know the word universe comes from two Latin words, uni, which means single, and verse means a spoken sentence. You know, we have verse and prose. Did you know we live in a single spoken sentence? God said, let there be. That'll preach, brother. There's a sermon right in there someplace, okay? And if you can't find it, you ain't got no preaching you at all, okay? All the matter in the universe was concentrated into one very dense, very hot region that may have been much smaller than a period on this page. What? Everything in the universe squished into a dot smaller than a period on a page. Wow. That's one crowded dot. And heavy, too. Hey, boys and girls, it ain't the first time it happened, either. This textbook says, after many billions of years, all the matter and energy will once again be packed into a small area, no bigger than the period at the end of the sentence. Then another big bang will occur. It happens every 80 to 100 billion years. So you can forget about global warming. We're going to get squished. Can you believe they cut down a tree to print that? Where's Al Gore when you need him? That's what I want to know. Now, the guy that wrote this book was brilliant. I couldn't believe how smart this guy was. He said, boys and girls, nothing really means nothing. You have to be at least that smart to write a book. He said, not only matter and energy would disappear, but also space and time. However, physicists theorize that from the state of nothingness, the universe began in a gigantic explosion. What? Yes, boys and girls, you see, one day, nothing exploded. And here we are. Oh, well, that explains it, yeah. The Big Bang Theory started about 1965. A little before that, they said the thing that exploded was a few light years in diameter. Then they said, oh, no, it's only 275 million miles. Then they reduced it to 71 million miles. Then 54,000. Then they've made it a trillionth the diameter of a proton. Now that's tiny. Boy, we're talking tiny now. And now they say just nothing. Yeah. Here's Discover Magazine a couple years ago. Where did everything come from? Boys and girls, the universe burst into something from absolutely nothing. Zero, nada. As it got bigger, it became filled with even more stuff that came from absolutely nowhere. How is that possible? Ask Alan Guth. His theory explains everything. Wow, I gotta meet this Alan Guth guy. Well, Alan Guth said in Scientific American, the observable universe, that would be us, could have evolved from an infinitesimal region. In the Greek, that's a dot. He said, it's then tempting to go one step further and speculate that the entire universe evolved from literally nothing. Yes, boys and girls, you see, we all came from a dot, and the dot came from nothing. And they call that science and put it in a science book? I'd call that a fairy tale and put it in the garbage. I said, Professor, what happened to your dot? He said, well, Hovind, 20 billion years ago, all the dirt in the universe was drawn into this little bitty tiny dot, and it was spinning. It spun faster and faster, and one day, it exploded, big bang. And the pieces that flew off became the galaxies and sun, moon, stars, and finally people. You know, here we are, nothing but stardust. I said, sir, can I ask you a few questions, please? He said, sure, what do you want to know? I said, well, you told me 20 billion years ago, all the dirt got together for the big squish and the big spin and the big bang. Where'd all this dirt come from? You know, who made matter? He said, we don't know about that. I said, okay, now hold it, sir. If I told you that I believe about 6,000 years ago God created the heaven and the earth, then you're going to say, and where did God come from? And I don't know. But you said 20 billion years ago there was a big bang, and you don't know where the dirt came from. So basically, I believe in the beginning God, and you believe in the beginning dirt. Don't tell me my theory is religion and yours is science. They're both religion. But the news media tries to make it always look like it is science versus religion. I did a debate in El Paso, Texas, and they said, religious and scientific leaders debate evolution. What are they trying to imply just by the title? You see how they always try to make evolution part of science? No, evolution's a religion. Both creation and evolution are religious. I mean, you have to believe in either one. The difference is the evolution religion is tax-supported religion. That's the difference. Mm-hmm. By the way, these two timelines, it's the same information right here. The Bible teaches about 6,000 years ago, God made everything. 4,400 years ago, there was a flood, wrecked everything, dropped everybody's property value to zero. 2,000 years ago, Jesus came, and here we are today waiting for the Lord to come back in about 5 minutes. Okay? This is the Bible view of history. On this chart, every inch is 150 years. That's a long time. If I was to show you what the 20 billion year chart would look like at the same scale as this one, this bottom chart would have to be 2,100 miles long. That's from Pensacola to Portland, Oregon. I don't want to carry a chart that big. So I made a new scale for this one, okay? The professor said he did not know where the matter came from. I said, well, sir, could you tell me where the laws came from? You know, the universe is run by laws. Gravity, centrifugal force, inertia, Boyle's law, Cole's law. You eat that with potato salad. Who made the laws? And by the way, why aren't the laws still evolving? Why are the laws always so steady? The laws don't evolve. Gravity's consistent. Why don't you weigh more 10 pounds one day than you do? You see, I do. No, I'm not. Never mind. Where did the energy come from? I mean, who bought the gas to run this machine? It takes energy to make something move. Where did the energy come from? The professor said, well, we don't know about that. I said, sir, could I ask you another question? He said, sure. What else would you like to know? Else? What do you mean, else? You haven't told me nothing yet. I said, does Berkeley have a merry-go-round? How many of you know what a merry-go-round is? You go round, round, round till you puke, okay? He said, no, we don't have a merry-go-round at Berkeley. I said, you ought to get one, man. You could learn some good science on a merry-go-round. If you put some fourth graders on a merry-go-round, any fourth graders in here? Who's in fourth grade? All right, I like fourth graders. I spent the best 5 years of my life in the fourth grade. That was before they diagnosed ADD. We're going to put some fourth graders on the merry-go-round, and we're going to get the high school football team out there to get it spinning clockwise as fast as it will possibly go. Now, if you have a digital watch, you may not know what clockwise means. I'll tell you later, okay? We're going to spin the merry-go-round clockwise. The kids are going to go through four phases. They start off in phase one. They're screaming at the football players, come on, let's go. Can't you go faster? Let's go. Move it, move it. You get up around 30 miles an hour. The kids enter phase two, where they stop screaming. They just quietly concentrate on trying to hang on for dear life. You get up around 60 miles an hour, and the kids enter phase three, where they start screaming again. But now they're screaming, stop, stop, please slow down. Don't stop, they'll keep going faster and faster. When you get to about 100 miles an hour, you should go into phase four. That's where the kids begin to fly off the merry-go-round. Now, when this happens, you will notice an interesting phenomena of physics. If the merry-go-round is spinning clockwise, when the kid flies off, the kid will be spinning clockwise until he encounters resistance, like a tree or a telephone pole. That's because of a law known as the conservation of angular momentum. You see, if a spinning object breaks apart in a frictionless environment, the fragments will always spin the same way because the outside's moving faster than the inside. People say, what if they hit each other? They can't hit each other. Drop a hand grenade off, let it explode. The longer you wait, the further apart the fragments become. How are they going to hit each other out there in the field someplace? Duh. We could talk all night about the conservation of angular momentum, but the professor said, yes, I'm familiar with the conservation laws. I said, well then good, sir, I have a question for you. If the universe began as a swirling dot, big bang, like you said, shouldn't everything be spinning the same way? He said, yes. I said, would you tell me why then that two and possibly three of the planets are spinning backwards? Can you tell me why eight of the 91 known moons are spinning backwards? Will you tell me why four planets have moons going both directions at the same time? Can you explain to me why some whole galaxies are spinning backwards? He said, that's interesting. I said, no, sir, that's more than interesting. That's kind of hard on your Big Bang theory. He said, why do you think they're going backwards? I was hoping he was going to ask that. I said, sir, it's very simple. You see, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth, and God did it that way on purpose, just to make the Big Bang theory look stupid. Now, I do believe in the Big Bang, and I told him I believe in the Big Bang because the Bible teaches the Big Bang. It says the heavens shall pass away with a great noise. The original Greek, that's a Big Bang. Mm-hmm. See? So there's going to be a Big Bang, but it didn't happen yet. So kids, if you go to school and some teacher says, do you believe in the Big Bang? You can say, yes, I do, and you better get saved and get ready for it. The Big Bang is coming soon to a city near you. Mm-hmm. By the way, if the Big Bang theory were true, the matter would be evenly distributed throughout the universe, and it's not. It's lumpy. They're called galaxies, and in bazillions of miles of nothing, called voids. That's why they're so desperate to come up with theories like black holes, dark matter, antimatter. They're looking for some way to salvage the Big Bang and still explain the missing matter. Even Fred Hoyle said, I have little hesitation saying a sickly pall now hangs over the Big Bang theory. The theory's been dead for 20 years. They just don't want to bury it because they don't have a replacement. The only other thing they've thought of is God did it. Oh, we don't want that, so let's hang on to the Big Bang theory. Get the book The Evolution Cruncher if you want a whole lot more on that. Here, the second law of thermodynamics. Now, the word thermodynamics, thermo means heat, and dynamics means power. So it's the power of heat. You can't just create things from nothing. And whenever there's an exchange of energy, there's something lost. The second law of thermodynamics tells us everything tends toward disorder. If you leave something alone for a while, it's going to rot, rust, die, fall apart, or break down. Nothing gets better by itself. That's what the Bible teaches. It says, the heavens are the works of thy hands. They shall perish. They wax old as doth a garment. Nothing gets better by itself. Okay? Take a look at your hairdo when you wake up in the morning. You'll see what I'm talking about. Everything tends toward chaos. There is Sue at 20. Here she is at 90. And here she is at 3,000. Mm-hmm. So, it's going to be you too, by the way, and me too. No. But the textbook says we're getting better. Humans probably evolved from bacteria more than 4 billion years ago. Was your great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandpa bacteria? Now, the evolutionists will say, Hovind, don't you know you can add energy and overcome the second law of thermodynamics? And they'll say, the sun adds energy to the earth, so that's how evolution works, because the earth receives extra energy. Well, it sounds good, but that doesn't, it's not true, okay? It's a deceitful argument. You see, the universe is a closed system by definition. Secondly, adding energy is destructive unless there's something to use the energy. Just adding energy doesn't solve it. Did you know the Japanese added a whole bunch of energy to Pearl Harbor one day? They did not organize a thing for us, did they? A couple of years later, we returned the favor and added energy to some of their cities, didn't we? Didn't organize nothing. I'm telling you, folks, adding energy is destructive. See, the sun adds energy to your house, but it's going to destroy the roof on your house, not build it. The sun's energy will destroy your entire house. The sun's energy will destroy the roof on your car. It'll destroy the paint job on your car. It'll destroy the fabric in your drapes and your upholstery and your carpet. There's only one thing that can use the sun's energy, chlorophyll. And one little plant cell is more complex than a space shuttle. And you want to believe it evolved by chance, you just go ahead and enjoy yourself. I don't care what you believe, but that's not science. Now, this textbook shows the kids a fossil of a starfish. And it says, boys and girls, 3.4 billion years old, the remains of the early ancestors of modern human beings. Was your great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandpa a starfish? I bet he could pick peaches like crazy. All right, now please do not laugh at this next picture. This will be a picture of my brother when he first wakes up in the morning after his first cup of coffee, which apparently was a little too strong. By the way, kids, we need to warn you, listen carefully. Kids, pay attention. Do not drink coffee. Because if you drink coffee when you're young, when you get married, your babies will be born naked and illiterate. And tea is worse. There was an Indian once that drank 4 gallons of iced tea. That night, he drowned in his teepee. Serious stuff. Don't drink that. Anyway, this will be a picture of my brother. Now, please don't laugh. He can't help it. There he is, right there. Notice what the textbook says. 30 million years ago. Now, kids, let me translate that for you. Anytime a book says millions of years ago, what it really means is long ago and far away. It means a fairy tale is coming next. Mm-hmm. 30 million years ago, these critters evolved. Ooh, there's that word again. You gotta watch that one, remember? 6 different meanings. It says they're ancestral to both humans and modern apes. Ancestors to humans? Grandpa? What big eyes you have, Grandpa. The better to see you with, my boy. You know, we've been teaching our kids they're nothing but an animal, and today, a lot of them act like animals. Barbara Reynolds figured it out. She's a liberal journalist. She said, your kids go ape in school? Here's why. He's being taught evolution. Guess what, Johnny? You're an animal and share a common heritage with earthworms. You mean I'm just an animal? Okay. What do you expect? Have you noticed the rock and roll music these days is all full of death and destruction and blood? Well, the Bible says they that hate me love death. That's the problem. Kids are taught today there are no absolutes. By the way, if evolution is true, that's exactly correct. I've asked this question to evolutionists all over the world. I've never had one answer, a simple question. I'll say, hey, sir or ma'am, I have a simple question for you. If evolution is true, how do we tell right from wrong? How does anybody tell right from wrong if evolution is true? They say there are no absolutes. One professor I debated said there are no absolutes. I said, are you absolutely sure? Blew his little brain. Now, wait, how can I be sure of that? Yes, there are absolutes. Thus saith the Lord. That's absolute. And the Lord said, ye shall not make any cuttings in your flesh for the dead, nor print any marks upon you. Some people, maybe they just don't know, okay? I understand. Maybe they just don't care what God's word says. But God told us what to do, and we're not doing it, okay? Anyway, that's another long, interesting story. Teachers don't seem to understand. It's perfectly fine for you to teach creation science in a public school. If you're a public school teacher and you want to teach the kids about creation, just do it. You don't need to ask any questions. You don't need to get any permission. There's never been a law against teaching creation science. Now, 2 states passed laws to require creation be taught, Arkansas and Louisiana. In both cases, the court struck it down and said you cannot require that they teach creation. If you passed a law in California that said you are required to breathe, the court would strike it down. You can't require that they breathe. I mean, you probably should, okay? But they can't make you if you don't want to, all right? And so they can't require creation be taught. Even Stephen Gould said, no statute exists in any state to bar instruction in creation science. It could be taught before and it can be taught now. There's never been a law against teaching creation in the schools, never. We cover much more on that in video 5. What's happened though, the ACLU, which is the American Communist Lawyers Union, They have, yeah. The ACLU has learned all they have to do is threaten to sue a school. They don't have to sue them. They threaten to sue, and the principal calls in the teachers and says, okay, guys, now listen. Don't teach creation because we might get sued. Now the teacher's got a problem. The court says they can. The law says they can. Their boss says they can't. And that's where it's breaking down, right there. But if a teacher does get up in front of their class and teach evolution, if you get up there and say, okay, kid, listen, you started off like a slime and you very slowly evolved to a human. You don't need to be a genius to figure out that teaching is going to destroy some kid's faith in the Bible. And anybody that destroys a child's faith better see what Jesus has to say about that. He said, whoso shall offend one of these little ones which believe in me, it were better for him that a millstone were hanged about his neck and he were drowned in the depth of the sea. Jesus said, James said, be not many masters, knowing we shall receive the greater condemnation. Back in the 1950s, here in America, there was very little evolution in the average textbook. 2,000 to 3,000 words in the whole textbook. They didn't talk about it much. Then in 1957, the Russians beat us in the space race by launching Sputnik, and Americans panicked. How many of you are old enough to remember the panic in America when the Russians were winning the space race? People were building bomb shelters. I mean, it was horrible, right? And somebody said, well, the Russians are ahead in science. That's why, you know, because they teach evolution. That's why they're beating us in the space race. What does evolution have to do with putting up a satellite? Then in 1959, it was the 100-year anniversary of Charlie Darwin's book coming out. And in 1959, Eisenhower asked Congress for $1 billion to teach evolution to the kids in school. He said, we need to get a whole new science curriculum pushing evolution. One organization, the National Science Foundation, got $10,500,000, developed a 9-part theme curriculum teaching evolution. They produced a series called BSCS, Biological Sciences Curriculum Study. And by 1963, the average textbook in America had 33,000 words about evolution. By 1963, prayer was taken out of our schools. Anybody remember that? Madeline Murray O'Hare? 1963 is when we saw a great rise in premarital sex for every single age group. Since 1963, we've seen a great rise in sexually transmitted diseases for kids 10 to 14 years of age. We've seen a great rise in unwed birth rates. That's a 100% increase in birth rates. There's been a 500% increase in pregnancies. The difference is being aborted. We cover that on video 4. Right now, 1/3 of all the kids born at the hospital are born to a couple that is not married. Illegitimate children. Now listen carefully. If you are one of those, God loves you and can use you in a powerful way. You know, Timothy never should have been born. The Jews weren't supposed to marry anybody outside the Jewish race. Timothy's mother married a Greek. Timothy's the result. He said, God, I want to serve you. God said, okay, son, I'll take you. So if your parents messed up, you listen carefully. You shut your mouth and quit your whining and go serve God with your life. No excuses, okay? There's been a 725% increase in unmarried couples living together. God's word hasn't changed. Whoremongers and adulterers, God will judge. He said, thou shalt not commit adultery. And Jesus said, if you even look in lust, you've committed adultery already in your heart. By the way, ladies, that's why it's important how you dress, okay? My daddy always said, if you're not in business, don't advertise. There's been an incredible rise in divorce rates until they finally just stopped getting married. And then divorce rates dropped off. Because why? You can't get divorced because you're not married, right? The violent crimes have increased nearly 1,000% since 1963. Now, I'm not that old, but I remember the days when you did not have to lock your house. Anybody remember those days? And you left the keys in the ignition all the time. You never took them out because you might lose them. And you go to the average high school, and half the pickup trucks in the parking lot had a loaded rifle hanging in the back window, and nobody got shot in school back in those days. You probably didn't hear about this, but the kids at Columbine that shot everybody were strong believers in evolution. They did the shooting on Hitler's birthday on purpose. They shot Isaiah just because he was black. Hitler hated black people. We covered that on video 4. They shot Rachel and Cassie just because they were Christian. And right after the shooting, Rosie O'Donnell got on her program and said, "See, we need more gun control." Rosie, those kids broke 18 gun laws going into that school. 2 more gun laws would not have slowed them down. See, Rosie can't figure it out. But one guy figured out the whole thing and put it on the tire cover on his van. I saw that. I said, "I have got to get a picture of this. This explains it all." He said, "Blaming guns for Columbine is like blaming spoons for Rosie O'Donnell being fat." Not the spoon's fault, Rosie. Okay. Anyway. SAT scores have plummeted since 1963. They finally had to dumb down the test in 95 to make the scores go back up, to make the kids look smarter. Teen suicide rate has gone crazy. Now look, if I told you if you kissed a frog, it would turn to a prince. You say, "No, frogs don't turn to princes." How many of you ladies got your husband by kissing a frog? Come on now, let me see. Only 2, okay. Doesn't happen very often, but in the textbooks it does. Yes, boys and girls, we started like an amoeba, and we slowly evolved to a frog. There he is, Grandpa. And then very slowly evolved to a prince. It's the same fairy tale, frog turns to prince. But see, instead of a kiss, no, they got a new magic ingredient. If the frog turns to the prince quickly, we all know it's a fairy tale. But if the frog turns to the prince slowly, that's modern science. It's the same fairy tale, folks, but they have a new magic ingredient. The new ingredient to turn the frog to a prince is billions and billions of years. How many have ever heard that expression before? Billions of years ago. It's on TV. It's on Carl Sagan's show, Cosmos. Billions and billions of years ago. It's in the magazines. It's in National Pornographic. Geographic. No. Billions and billions of years ago. Here's a 4th grade textbook. Millions of years ago. Now, kids, listen. If anybody ever says, "Millions of years ago," just say, "Excuse me, were you there?" They'll say, "Well, no, of course I wasn't there." Then you can say, "Now, teacher, do you know the earth is millions of years old? I mean, is this really part of science? Is this something we can observe and study and test and demonstrate in the laboratory? Or is this just something people believe?" They're going to say, "Well, everybody believes the earth is millions of years old." No, they don't. Most Americans think the earth is less than 10,000 years old and God made it. Only 4% are atheistic. I think that 4% ought to go start themselves a private school and teach evolution to anybody that wants to pay and come learn it. And they ought to get it out of our public schools. That's my unbiased opinion. Yeah. One textbook author said, "The results of this and other similar surveys are startling because evolution's been a settled issue in science for 150 years. Maybe it's settled in his little brain." It is true that slightly more than half of the scientists believe in evolution. Those are the ones that have not been to my seminar yet. Okay. But even if a bunch of scientists believe in something, that doesn't make it true. There was a time when the scientists taught the planets go around the Earth. There was a time when the scientists taught big rocks fall faster than little rocks. That was taught for 2,000 years, and it's not true. They fall the same speed. They used to teach, if you're sick, you have bad blood. Take out your blood, and you'll get better. That's how George Washington died. They had special places all over the country to get your blood taken out. You could tell where they were because they had a white pole with a red stripe around it. The barber was the bloodletter. Still is today, sometimes. And right beside George Washington, when they bled him to death, was a Bible that told him the life of the flesh is in the blood. Man, if they'd have read that verse, he might still be alive today. Well, he'd live longer, okay? Now listen, if you went scuba diving and you found a treasure chest full of gold coins, and I asked you the simple question, when did the boat sink? And you say, "Oh, I don't know." Look at the dates on the coins. See, if there's a coin in there from 1750, you ought to be able to figure out the boat sank after 1750. How many can figure this out with no help? Okay. It couldn't sink before that, right? You don't go poking around in the box and find the oldest coin. You find the youngest coin, and that becomes what is called the limiting factor. The boat could not be older than that. Couldn't have sunk before that. There are all kinds of ways to limit the age of the Earth to less than billions of years. Now, if you find a dinosaur bone, like the one I've got in my museum, a dinosaur toe bone, you should notice two things about it immediately. Number one, it does not talk. Number two, it does not have a date stamped on it. It does not say, made by a dinosaur, 70 million BC, in Taiwan. It doesn't say that, okay? So how do you tell the age of a fossil? How would you tell the age of the Earth? Go outside and get a shovel full of dirt and tell me how old it is. Well, the only way to tell for sure how old something is to ask the guy who made it. Now, he knows for sure. And the Bible says God created the heaven and the earth. So I bet God knows how old it is. And the Bible tells us in Colossians that Jesus created heaven and earth. Well, guess what? That's one of many verses that proves Jesus is God Almighty in the flesh. And Jesus said pretty clearly in Matthew chapter 19, "Have you not read that he which made them at the beginning made them male and female?" By the way, it was Adam and Eve, not Adam and Steve. You got to say that these days. But Jesus said that was the beginning. Same thing in Mark 10:6. Well, now hold it. If that is the beginning, then we can figure out the age of the earth. Because the Bible says death came by sin. You know why we have death and suffering in the world today? It's because of Adam's sin. The Bible tells us clearly by man came death. In Adam, all die. Man brought death into the world, according to Scripture. Now, according to evolution, death brought man into the world. Absolute opposite. And the Bible says Adam was the first man. It's real clear about the topic. And Eve was the mother of all living. So that makes it pretty simple. Adam was 130 when Seth was born. Seth was 105 when Enos was born. Enos was 90 when Canaan was born. If you go through the Bible and add up the dates, it's easy to do, folks. There's a couple of tricky spots in there. But you can go through the Bible and add up the dates, and you're going to get about 6,000 years for the total history of the world. You can get these charts. I've got one down here at the bottom of this, hanging from the bottom. If you get my seminar notebook, the last page folds out to be this chart. We also have them laminated if you want them for placemats when your skeptic friends come for lunch. You can really stir up a conversation with one of those things. But anyway, if you add up the dates in the Bible, you get about 4,000 BC for the creation. Now, I don't try to put an exact date on it, okay? I don't say the creation was 4,004 BC, October 23rd at 2 in the afternoon, okay? I don't think you can get that close. I think Adam was made in the afternoon because it's just before Eve. It's the only clue I found. And I can't prove this, but I think I figured out why God made Adam first. I think God made Adam first because he didn't want any advice on how to do it. That's right. I can see it now. No, God, you're doing it wrong. Shut up, Eve. I know what I'm doing, okay? Now, B.C. means before Christ. Just about every new textbook has changed it. They're calling it B.C.E. It means before the Common Era. You just check it out, folks. Christ is gone out of the schools. One guy said, "Why didn't God stop the shooting at Columbine High School?" It's easy. God's not allowed in school anymore. Don't blame him. We got a problem here. Now, the textbook says the earth is billions of years old. Jesus said the creation of Adam was the beginning. Was Jesus lying? Did he not understand modern science, or was he right? How old is this earth anyway? Well, we cover about 50 different ways to prove the earth is not billions of years old on the second half of videotape number one back there on the table. I don't have time to cover that tonight. But if the earth is only 6,000 years old, then what about dinosaurs? Where do they fit in? Well, it's real simple. Dinosaurs were big lizards with Adam and Eve. Noah took them on the ark. You see, dinosaurs on the ark, they're kind of big, aren't they? Well, the big ones were big, but the little ones were little. And Noah was 600 years old when he went on that boat. I just bet he was smart enough to figure out you don't have to bring the biggest ones. Bring two babies. Just be sure to get a pink one and a blue one. That'll be important later, okay? There's all kinds of reasons for bringing babies on the ark, okay? Now listen, kids, we cover all that on video number 3, all about dinosaurs. There could be some still alive today. Loch Ness Monster, Lake Champlain Monster, the one that washed up on the beach in California, 1925. All those pictures are on the website. But listen, kids, your textbook's going to tell you that you are an animal. Don't you believe that for one second. You were made in God's image. And you're going to stand before God one of these days and give an answer for everything you've ever said or thought or done or thought about doing. God keeps careful records. He's got it all. And if you want to get that record erased, there's only one way to do it. That's the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, which cleanseth us from all iniquity. Praise God. All right, let's summarize here. God made the world. He owns it. He makes the rules. We are all guilty of breaking his rules. He told us pretty clearly, thou shalt not bear false witness. Don't lie. These are the Ten Commandments. How many of you have ever told a lie in your life? Put your hand up. Come on, are you doing another one? Don't give me that pious look. Get your hand up here, brother. Okay. Number 8, thou shalt not steal. How many ever stole something? Come on, you already told me you're a liar. Put your hand up. Okay. Okay, so far we know we're all a bunch of lying thieves, right? Do you want to read the whole list and see how we're doing? We better stop right there. There's no question we're guilty. The Bible says, evil shall not dwell with thee. If you've committed one sin, you're guilty. You're going to hell. And some people think, well, God's going to weigh my good works against my bad works. Well, who on earth told you that? Why don't you go before the judge and say, Judge, I only murdered one person. Look at all the people I didn't murder. You got to weigh my good against my bad. Duh. He's not going to fall for that. And neither's God. We're guilty, folks, so we're going to be punished. Or we can find a substitute. Now, I can't substitute for your sins because I have a whole bunch of my own, okay? And you can't substitute for mine because you have a bunch of your own, too. But Jesus Christ is not only willing, he's able. He's the only one who's able to substitute for your sins. I can't. You can't for mine. He's the only one who lived a sinless life. And praise God, he's willing also. Hey, if you died today, where would you go? I tell people, you really ought to think about that because you're going to be dead for a long time. George Washington died 205 years ago, and he is still dead. How much longer does he have to go? I don't care how long you live, you're going to be dead longer than that. Think about it. You could die tonight. Have you seen the way they drive in Southern California? You got some rednecks moved out here, folks. I'm telling you what. You can get killed this evening. I'm going to die someday. I'm going to try to make it the last thing I do, but it's going to happen, okay? It's going to happen to you, too. Now, all you get in this life is a little bitty dash between two dates. That's it. Someday there's going to be a rock with your name on it. You know I'm telling you the truth. What are you doing with your dash? Little boy came to Jesus one day, said, Jesus, you look like you're hungry. You've been preaching all day. Here, Jesus, you can have my sack lunch. I don't have much, only got 5 biscuits and 2 fish sticks, but you can have it. Jesus said, son, you mean I can have your whole lunch? He said, yeah, Jesus, go ahead. He said, well, son, have a seat right there. Watch this. 5,000 men, plus women, plus children, probably at least 20,000 people. Jesus said, okay, everybody sit down. They all sat down. He reached in that little boy's sack lunch and started making fish sandwiches and passed them all out, fed everybody in the crowd, including that little boy. That's interesting. When they got done, they picked up 12 baskets full of leftovers and sent them home with that little boy. Here, son, take this home to mama. Now, that little boy could have kept his lunch and fed himself. He decided to give it away, and he fed himself. And 20,000 more people, and got his name in the Bible. Not his name, but his story. Now, I don't know what you're going to do with your life. You can do whatever you please with your life. I don't know what you're going to do. I'm leaving tomorrow morning. But listen, I would recommend you take your little life and say, Jesus, would you do something with this? Would you just do something? See, this is America, folks. You can work hard and make a lot of money and buy yourself a nice house, nice car, nice boat, have vacations. You really can live it up in this country. You really can. You can live your life for yourself if you want. That is your choice. Or you can live your life for the Lord, and then He will take care of what you need. It's amazing. I don't know what motivates you folks around here. I don't know. You just met me tonight. I just met you. But let me tell you what motivates me. 35 years ago, last week, I gave my heart to the Lord and got saved. I was a 16-year-old kid in high school, East Peoria, Illinois. I'd been saved for a couple of months. I was reading my Bible, going to church, growing, you know. And it was an independent, temperamental, fundamental, right-wing, radical, chicken-eating Baptist church I was going to. The preacher actually banged on the pulpit. I had never seen that before. I was raised in the Methodist church. We had two pulpits. One pulpit where they read the Bible from and another pulpit where he preached from. It took me a long time to figure out why. But it's because what he's reading over here is so far from what he's saying over here. Had to separate them, you know. And I was growing in the Lord, reading my Bible, going to church, you know, and thinking, this is great, you know. And then one day a friend of mine said, hey, Kent, do you want to go with me to the Heart of Illinois Fair? I said, what's going on? He said, we got a booth set up for campus life, and we're witnessing to folks. I said, you're what? We're witnessing. We're telling them about how to get saved. I said, I've never told anybody how to get saved. I don't know how to do it. He said, well, come on, I'll just give you one of the easy jobs. I said, okay. They had a couple of Volkswagen seats up there on the stage with wires in them, and people would sit down and they'd hit the button, and if you hit the button after the light turned green, you shock the other guy, but if you hit it too soon, you shock yourself, you know, bam, ooh, ah. And they're having contests who can shock the other guy, you know, and they use that to draw a crowd in there. Pretty cool idea. Anyway, our job was to go out into the crowd and get them to fill out a questionnaire, just 10 simple questions. The last question said, would you like to get to know God better? And if they said yes, we were supposed to bring them to the back of the tent and introduce them to one of the people in the back of the tent who would lead them to Jesus Christ, a soul winner. I was having fun, man. First 2 days, I'm out there bringing people back. Hey, you want to get to know God better? Sure, come with me. Bring them to the back, open up the tent flap. George, this is Herman. He wants to get to know God better. Oh, Herman, come on in, and I'd go back and get me another one. It was fun. Third night, Heart of Illinois Fair. Noise every place, kids on the stage getting, you know, shocked and everything. I went out, a big old football player there from Richwoods High School. I said, hey, would you fill out a questionnaire for me? He said, sure. He wrote answered the questions. Last one, I said, would you like to get to know God better? He said, yes, I would. I said, all right, come with me. I'd done it before, nothing to it, you know. We walked back to the back of the tent, opened up the tent flap. There was nobody there. He said, what do we do now? I said, well, I guess I'll show you. Keep in mind now, I'd never led anybody to the Lord in my life. This guy's twice my size. We went down, sat in the chairs, and the old metal chairs in the back of the tent in the Heart of Illinois Fair. And I didn't know what to do, so I pulled a gospel tract out of my pocket, God's Four Spiritual Laws. I said, let me read this to you. I sat there and read the whole thing. At the end, it says, would you like to receive Christ? He said, yes, I would. I thought, oh, brother, what do I do now? I got him on the hook, and I can't land him. I said, well, it says pray this prayer. I said, let's close our eyes and bow our heads, and I'll pray first, and you repeat after me. He said, okay. I kept one eye open. I read the prayer off the track. I really did. Read the prayer. Lord, I'm a sinner. He said, Lord, I'm a sinner. I deserve to go to hell, you know, but I believe you died for me, and I want you to forgive me and save me right now. We got done. He looked at me and shook my hand. He said, Kent, thank you. I've been worried about this for 2 weeks. I said, you're welcome. And he walked out. Noise every place. I mean, this is a carnival, you know. And here I'm standing all by myself in the back of this tent. I thought, man. That was fun, showing somebody how to go to heaven. I got down on my knees in the dirt next to that metal chair, and I said, Lord, It's me, it's Kent. I'm a brand new Christian, and Lord, this is all confusing to me. I'll just tell you right now, I'm confused about a lot of things. I said, Lord, I don't know what you want me to do with my life. I don't know. I said, but Lord, if it's okay with you, I think I'd like to do this the rest of my life. I would just like to introduce people to you for the rest of my life. Well, it's been 35 years. Nothing's changed. I don't know what's important to you. Now, kids, you got 1,000 distractions in this world, I understand. I decided 35 years ago, I'm going to give my dash to Jesus. See what he can do with it. Some of you can give it to making money. You can give it to, you can give your dash to all sorts of things. I don't know what you're going to do with your life. That's a decision you got to make. I'd recommend you do what I did, though. And it's never too late. You can be 85 years old and still give your dash to Jesus. And you say, Lord, I don't have much left, but you can have this. He can still feed 5,000 people with just a crumb. If all you got's a crumb left, he'll take it. If you're a Christian here tonight, what on earth are you doing for heaven's sake? There's a war going on. Can't you find something to do? If you're not going to shoot, carry bullets. Take care of the wounded. Do something, okay? Everybody ought to start a ministry. The worst of you could serve as bad examples, if nothing else. Find something to do with your life. Influence somebody for Jesus. Man, that's all I want to do. Well, we're over time tonight. We could talk all night about this, but if you want to use our materials, feel free. They're not copyrighted. I told the Lord when I started this ministry 15 years ago, I said, Lord, there's a lot of things about your church I don't like. He said, son, I agree. I said, if you want me to go preach, I'm not going to copyright my stuff. I'm not going to charge anything for my seminars, and I'm not going to send out a letter every month begging for money. And if you don't supply, I'm going to quit, okay? He won't let me quit. Preached 830 times last year. We got all kinds of videos on lots of different languages, Spanish, French, German. You can get one of our catalogs out there. We have all kinds of dinosaur fossil stuff you can use for witnessing tools, and get our college courses. If you want to go down deep, stay down long, come up dry. If we can help, that's what we're here for. Let's all stand, bow our heads, and let's pray. Heavenly Father, would you please raise up some soul winners out of this bunch? Lord, right within 10 miles of where we're standing, there are thousands and thousands and thousands of people headed to hell. Thousands of them. And Lord, we keep thinking the mission field's across the ocean someplace when it's right across the street. It's right next door. It's people we bump into at gas stations and toll booths and the grocery store and sit next to in school. And Lord, everybody here knows somebody that's going to hell. We're going to meet somebody tonight that's going to go to hell, Father, unless somebody shows them. Would you please get some of these Christians to quit worrying about who wins the dumb ball game and start worrying about who's going to heaven or hell? Send a revival, please, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, it's an honor to be here in Jacksonville, Florida tonight. My name's Kent Hovind. I taught high school science for 15 years. And now for 15 years, I've been an evangelist doing seminars on creation, evolution, and dinosaurs. And I tell people up front what I believe. The Bible says very clearly that all Scripture is given by inspiration of God. And I believe the Bible is literally true and scientifically accurate. And I think the evolution theory that's being taught in our schools is one of the dumbest and most dangerous ideas in the history of the world. So let's draw some clear lines like the name of the conference is, okay? That ought to be a clear line right there. This is not my wife. That's just a picture of her. We have three kids, and I got them all married off, and the dog died, so I made it. I'm home free. And got two grandkids, one more due in a couple months. So we're excited about this grandpa stage. Grandkids are God's reward for not killing your own kids when you thought about it. Amen. All right. The Bible says in Genesis 1:1, in the beginning. When was the beginning? We've got a split in Christianity today over this issue. When was the beginning? How old is the earth? And if you can't get past these first three words, how are you going to know when the rest of the Bible is literal or figurative? When was the beginning? Hebrews chapter 1 says, and thou, Lord, in the beginning hast laid the foundation of the earth. When was the beginning? How old is this earth anyway? Well, in the last session we talked about if you went scuba diving and you found a treasure chest full of gold coins and I asked you the simple question, when did the boat sink? You say, I don't know. Well, look at the dates on the coins. If there's a coin in there from 1750, you ought to be able to figure out the boat sank after 1750. How many can figure that out with no help? Okay. Well, this would be called a limiting factor. It cannot have sunk before that date. Now, there are many ways to test the age of the earth, but some of them limit the earth to less than the billions of years they're telling us in school. What we're going to look at tonight are some of the limiting factors for the age of the earth. And I'm going to tell you why I believe the Bible dates are exactly scientifically, historically, mathematically correct. This earth was created about 6,000 years ago, not millions of years ago. There was a flood 4,400 years ago. Completely destroyed the world. Dropped everybody's property value to zero in that big flood. Now, the Bible says that Jesus created all things, Colossians chapter 1. Genesis 1 says God created heaven and earth. Colossians 1 says Jesus created heaven and earth. Well, guess what? That's because Jesus is God Almighty in the flesh. And Jesus said in Matthew 19:4, have you not read that he which made them at the beginning made them male and female? Same thing in Mark 10:6. Was that really the beginning when he made Adam and Eve? Well, the Bible tells us clearly in Romans chapter 5 that death came into the world because of man's sin. The reason we have death and suffering is because of man's sin. 1 Corinthians 15 says, by man came death, in Adam all die. You see, nothing died until Adam sinned. And Adam was the first man. The Bible's extremely clear on this topic. And Eve was the mother of all living. And the Bible says Adam lived 130 years and had a son and named him Seth. Seth lived 105 years and begat Enos. Enos lived 90 years and begat Canaan. If you go through the Bible and add up the dates, it's pretty easy to do. There's a few tricky spots in there, but basically anybody can do it. The Bible dates add up to about 6,000 years ago, not millions. And we've got these charts. If you get my seminar notebook, the last page folds out to be one of these charts. Or if you want them laminated when you use them for placemats when your skeptic friends come over for lunch, that'll be an interesting tool to have at your house. But clearly, you're going to get about 6,000 years ago for the creation if you add up the dates in the Bible. Now, I would say that is a limiting factor. If somebody wants to say, well, the earth is millions of years old, okay, you're welcome to believe whatever you want to believe. I don't care what you believe. However, you need to understand your belief is in conflict with the clear teaching of God's Word. And if you don't care what God says, okay, that's fine also. Just so you understand, you're conflicting with what God said, and you're calling Jesus a liar. Jesus said the creation of Adam was the beginning. So the Bible dates start off at about 6,000 years ago, and then 4,400 years ago, there was a big flood. Now, I do many debates at universities. I've had 86 now. I've done over 6,000 radio and TV call-in talk shows, and atheists are always calling in saying, hey, Hovind, if Adam and Eve had Cain and Abel, who did their sons marry, huh? Well, that's a fair question. Who did Adam's sons marry? The Bible says Cain went out from the presence of the Lord and dwelt in the land of Nod, and Cain knew his wife, and she conceived and bare a son, called him, etc. Well, who's his wife? Well, notice it doesn't say he found her there. But who was his wife? And who did Seth marry anyway? Well, that's a good question. But that's nothing, no problem compared to what the evolutionists believe. See, they've got a serious problem. They believe 18 or 20 billion years ago, nothing exploded in the Big Bang. That's what the theory teaches. And then 4.6 billion years ago, the earth cooled down and it developed a hard rocky crust. Yes, boys and girls, and then it rained on the rocks. Oh, yes, millions of years of torrential rains created great oceans. This is what the textbooks teach in your town, folks, okay? And then it says, swirling in the waters of the oceans is a bubbling broth of complex chemicals. Progress from a complex chemical soup to a living organism is very slow. Sure is. Don't even happen. That's how slow it is. This guy said, the first self-replicating systems must have emerged in this organic soup. So according to the evolution theory, 20 billion years ago there was a big bang, 4.6 billion years ago the earth cooled down, then it rained on the rocks for millions of years and turned them into soup, and the soup came alive about 3 billion years ago. And that first life form found somebody to marry. Now there's a good trick. And something to eat, of course, and slowly evolved into everything we see today. So by their theory, great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandpa was soup. I didn't make it up. That's what they teach. Okay, anyway. Now, there are hundreds of varieties of dogs in the world today. I believe that all those dogs came from a common pair of dogs on Noah's Ark. But that is nothing compared to what the evolutionists believe. They believe all those dogs in the world today came from a rock 3 billion years ago. So, let's just put this in perspective when we study this topic. So anyway, who did Adam's sons marry? Well, the Bible says clearly Adam lived after he begat Seth 800 years and begat sons and daughters. Question, how many kids could you have in 800 years? Several, right? A friend of mine in Arkansas had 13 kids in 13 years. I met a family in Minnesota with 20 kids, all under 20. It's cold in Minnesota. Anyway, so who did Adam's sons marry anyway? Well, in the first generation, they married sisters. You say, married sisters? Well, calm down. First place, there is no other choice, okay? Secondly, who would you report them to? Think about it. Thirdly, there were no laws against it until 2,500 years later when Moses gave the law. See, for the first 2,500 years of human history, it was not a problem marrying sisters. There were no deformed chromosomes. You wouldn't have any deformed children. See, everything about you is inherited. Even having children is hereditary. If your parents don't have any, you won't either. You say, wow, I never thought of that. Go think about it. You'll see I'm right. People say, you can't marry sisters. What about genetic similarity? Adam married his rib. You talk about genetic similarity. It's not a problem, folks. Okay. Anyway, you won't notice this reading your Bible, but when you graph it out, you see some amazing things. Did you know that Adam lived long enough to know his great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandson? Noah's daddy could have known Adam for 56 years. Can you imagine a family reunion back in those days? All right, everybody hop on the camel. We're going to go visit great-great-great-great-great-great-grandpa Adam. And great-great-great-great-great-great-grandpa Adam is going to tell us what it was like in the Garden of Eden before the first woman ate the first man out of house and home. Or whatever happened back then. Anyway, you also won't notice this reading your Bible, but Noah's son Shem lived a long time after the flood. Shem lived long enough to know Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Now, it's an interesting story here. Jacob had 13 kids. One of them was named Joseph. He's the one that got the coat of many colors. The brothers beat him up and threw him in the pit, and he ended up down in Egypt, and he became the vice pharaoh, or whatever they call him. Okay, and he invited the brothers to move down and live with him. And so Joseph is introducing his dad to Pharaoh. And Pharaoh said to Jacob, how old are you? And he said, I'm 130. He said, but this is nothing. Few and evil have the days of the years of my life, men, but have not attained unto the days of the years of the life of my fathers. What's he talking about? He says, I'm 130, but this is nothing. Well, it's probably true when you consider he could have personally known Shem, Arphaxad, Selah, and Eber. See, if you're 130, but you know a 600-year-old down the street, you just don't feel so old, okay? Anyway, here we got a clear problem now, folks. You talk about some clear lines. And I like the name of this conference, brother, clear lines. That's the way we ought to draw it. The textbook says the earth is billions of years old. Jesus said the creation of Adam was the beginning. Somebody is wrong. So, was Jesus lying? Did he not understand modern science? Or was he right? How old is the earth anyway? Textbooks in your town and my town say the earth is billions of years old, millions of years ago. You see this on TV, it's in the magazines, it's all over the place. Billions and billions of years ago, we are bombarded with this propaganda. Even many Christians are teaching the earth is billions of years old. I debated Hugh Ross for 3 hours on the John Ankerberg Show, he won't debate me again, over the age of the earth question. I think this is an extremely important topic. Pat Robertson teaches it's billions of years old. The Navigators Bible Study Group that helped lead me to the Lord teach the earth is billions of years old. John Hagee teaches the earth is billions of years old. People say, who cares? Well, this is an important topic because that teaching clearly puts death before sin. Now, I don't think it's a heresy to think the earth is billions of years old, but I do think it's a heresy to teach there was death before sin. That's against the clear teaching of the Bible. The Bible says death reigned from Adam to Moses. There was no death until Adam sinned. See, Adam brought death and suffering into this world. The Bible's real clear on this topic. Now, some people say, who cares? It's not that important. Hugh Ross says, well, it shouldn't be a divisive issue. Okay, agree with me, and it won't be divisive. It's real simple, okay? For one thing, this issue is important because the credibility of Jesus Christ is at stake. Jesus quoted Genesis 25 times. So the question is, do we have to have a guru to tell us what the book means? Can we trust what Jesus said? Genesis itself clearly teaches that the earth was created in 6 days, about 6,000 years ago. Jesus said, creation of Adam was the beginning. Just about every other book in the Bible refers back to Genesis. This is an extremely important topic. This is the foundation. Now, the evolutionists really care about this topic because if you take away billions of years, their theory looks real silly. I think it looks real silly anyway, but it looks even sillier without their billions of years to hide in as a smokescreen, okay? Jesus said, had you believed Moses, you would have believed me. He wrote of me. And Moses clearly wrote at least the four books of the Pentateuch. He didn't write Genesis. He edited it. We'll get into that more on video number 7. Very interesting topic. But there's all kinds of scientific ways also. Not only does the Scripture teach the earth is 6,000 years old, and that's a clear line in the sand for me, the scientific evidence teaches the earth is not billions of years old. We're going to look at some of the limiting factors now for the age of the earth based on the scientific evidence. In 1999, they announced in the newspaper, last weekend the world's population topped the 6 billion mark. In 1985, there were 5 billion people on planet Earth. In 1800, there were 1 billion people here. Just about everybody agrees, around the turn of 1800th century, there were about 1 billion people on planet Earth. There's just not much argument about this. And everybody agrees the population is growing rapidly. There's no argument there. But the world is not overcrowded. Don't fall for that overcrowded propaganda. The entire world's population today could fit inside the city limits of Jacksonville, Florida, where we are. This city where you guys live has 25 billion square feet. You could fit everybody in the world in here twice. The world's not overcrowded. Have you driven across Nebraska? Huh? Or Kansas? Or Wyoming? Or Montana? Drive across Texas. Anybody ever driven across Texas before? You can go for 3 days. Are we still in Texas? Yeah, you're still in Texas. Look, if it's overcrowded where you are, move. Okay? Because the rest of the world is not overcrowded. All right. I was out digging dinosaurs last summer in Colorado, and I said to this lady that owned the ranch, I said, ma'am, how big is your ranch? She said, it's 213,000 acres. I said, what's property cost out here? She said, oh, about $17 an acre. I was up in Barrow, Alaska, last September. Talk about north. That's as far as you can get. You get Arctic Ocean after that. We went up and touched it, of course, you know. I said, how many people live in this county? He said, well, this county is called a borough up here. It's the North Slope Borough. It is about twice the size of Ohio. It's about 50% bigger than the whole state of Florida, just one county. Has a population of 10,000. I said, what's property cost up here? He said, cost? Come on up. Give it to you. How much you want? Back when Jesus was here, the population on planet Earth was about 250 million people. 250 million. There were lots of censuses done at that time. That's why Jesus was born in Bethlehem. I mean, all the rulers tried to count their people so they could tax them, you know. Nothing's changed over the years. So it's pretty well established that the population was about 250 million at the time of Christ, and it's now 6 billion. And if you plot the numbers on a graph, you can see it points clearly to the entire population starting about 4,400 years ago, when 8 people got off of Noah's Ark. See, if you start with 8 people having kids and grandkids and great-grandkids, you can get a population of 5 or 6 billion in a few thousand years. So if you believe in evolution, you got a serious problem. Because you think man's been here for 3 million years. Do you realize in 3 million years the population would have grown? Right now there'd be 150,000 people per square inch. That would be crowded. See, God told him pretty clearly to replenish the earth, fill the earth, go have lots of kids. He designed the world to be inhabited. That's why he formed it, Isaiah 45 tells us. He formed it to be inhabited. He wants lots of people here. But Satan, of course, wants the opposite of what God wants. We got people that work that believe just the opposite of what the Lord wants, like Jacques Cousteau, who said, in order to stabilize world population, we need to eliminate 350,000 people a day. Nice guy, Jacques. Ted Turner said we needed a 95% decline in world population levels. Okay, Ted, you first. There are some people who would like to reduce the population of this planet to 1.5 billion as soon as possible. They think we're hurting Mother Earth. And there are some powerful folks. We cover much more on that in our seminar, on a college series. We'd offer our seminar in 4 different college classes, everything where we chased every rabbit and kicked every dog as we had no time constraints. But I get more on that on CSE 101. Anyway, the population tells us the Earth has not been here for billions of years. At least man hasn't. Now, I don't know what's going to happen in the future about these idiots reducing the population, you know, with chemtrails and all that. We'll see, but we'll cover more on that in video 7. The fact is, the population says it's not been billions of years. Actually, scientists are agreeing now that there is a genetic bottleneck sometime in man's past. This article said that based on the DNA studies, they're putting a bottleneck theory. There used to be, just about everybody was wiped out down to just a few people, and we all descended from just a few people on Earth. Well, duh. I even know the names of some of those people. Noah, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Yeah, that was a bottleneck. Did you know the galaxies up in the sky are spinning, but they're going different speeds. The stars in the galaxy are going different speeds. If the stars in the middle are going faster than the stars at the outside. If the galaxies were billions of years old, they would no longer have these spiral arms. The spiral arm galaxies are proof they are not billions of years old. So if somebody wants to believe they are, okay, you believe whatever you want, but it goes against the clear scientific evidence from the galaxies. They cannot be billions of years old. Stars blow up about every 25 to 30 years. If it's a little one, they call it a nova. If it's a big one, they call it a supernova, okay? But about every 25 or 30 years, a star explodes. Well, they search the heavens with the Hubble telescope, and they can not even find 300 supernova rings. Question, if the universe is billions of years old, why aren't there billions of supernova rings? Why less than 300? Which would mean less than 10,000 years. Yeah. Some people say, well, new stars are forming in Crab Nebula. No, there is no evidence of new stars forming. There are some spots getting brighter, and you can interpret that as new stars forming if you'd like, but it's not proof the new star is forming. Could be the dust is clearing and there's a star behind it. Any freshman law student could tear your argument apart in a court of law. Textbook says it takes billions of years for red stars to turn to white stars. That's what the books teach. That is simply not correct. We have overwhelming evidence that stars do change. That, you know, they fall apart, they burn out. They change from red stars to white stars. There seems to be pretty good evidence for that. But we also have evidence it does not take billions of years. All the ancient astronomers said Sirius was a red star. Everybody just 2,000 years ago was describing Sirius as redder than Mars, one of the red stars. Today, it's a white dwarf. We know what happens in less than 2,000 years. Don't tell me it takes millions of years. That's simply not correct. We have, see, one good experiment is worth a pound of theory any day. And we've got experimental evidence we can see and test and prove it doesn't happen that long. Some of the planets are still hot, but they're cooling off. They're radiating more heat than they gain from the sun. They can't be billions of years old. It's just not logical to say Jupiter, which is losing heat, is billions of years old. It just can't be. Jupiter has a little moon called Ganymede. Ganymede has a strong magnetic field. When it was discovered about this strong magnetic field, they said, wow, that's strange. That indicates a hot core, and yet Ganymede should have cooled off billions of years ago. I wonder why it still has such a strong magnetic field. Well, I can tell them why. You see, about 6,000 years ago, God created everything. Ganymede's not even 6,000 years old yet. Well, a few days older than that. It's real simple. Saturn has rings around it, but the rings are unstable, and they're moving away from the planet. There are all kinds of factors that are affecting the rings of Saturn. Gravitational pulls and things like that. There's a good article about it in the book by Walt Brown in the beginning. Saturn's rings cannot be billions of years old. That fits the biblical theory that everything was created about 6,000 years ago. Okay, the moon is going around the Earth. How many knew that already? The moon goes around the Earth. Okay. Did you know as the moon goes around, it's gradually getting farther away? We're slowly losing the moon. It's only a couple inches a year, about 3 inches a year, so it's no big deal, nothing to worry about. Plus, there's nothing you can do about it anyway, okay? But the moon is getting farther from the Earth every year. Now, kids, this is going to be complicated, so listen carefully. The moon is getting farther from the Earth every year. So that means that it used to be closer. How many can figure this out? Now stay with me, okay? All right. Well, if you bring the moon in closer, you start to create a problem because the moon causes the tides. Now, you folks in Jacksonville probably have to worry about the tides, don't you? If a hurricane hits during high tide, you got a serious problem on your hand. Well, if you brought the moon in closer, the tides would be higher because of a law known as the inverse square law. If you brought the moon into one-third the distance, you take the one-third, inverse it, and square it, it's 9 times the gravitational pull. And if you run all the math on this, you'll find out about 1.2 billion years ago, the moon was whizzing around just above the surface of the Earth. Now, way before that, you're going to have a serious tide problem. So that explains what happened to the tall dinosaurs. They got mooned. Comets are flying around through space, but comets are constantly losing material. That's what the tail is blowing off of a comet. It's losing part of itself, okay? You can't just keep losing and losing. Pretty soon, it's gone. You know, it's kind of like your checkbook. See, if your outgo exceeds your income, your upkeep will be your downfall every single time. Well, these comets are losing material, and it's been estimated they can't last more than about 10,000 years. Okay, well, then I have a question. If the Earth is billions of years old, and if the universe is billions of years old, why do we still have comets? I mentioned this in a seminar one time, that this is an evidence that the universe is not billions of years old. Just the very existence of comets, like Halley's Comet, it proves it's not billions of years old. And this one atheist went home and devoted an entire website against me. There are now over 1,000 anti-Hovind websites. Type in Kent Hovind on the search engine and watch your computer melt. They hate me out there. So we spent about 2 months here last year, and we developed a series called Dr. Hovind Answers His Critics. And we answer all the stuff that they say on the websites on a video. You can get on video or DVD or audio track if you'd like, or CD if you want to listen to it as you drive. I give an answer to some of the stuff they're criticizing on there. But one of these atheists on his website, or you can also listen into my radio program. Go to Dr. Dino, my website, and go to the Creation Science Hour. We do a daily radio broadcast for an hour. Anybody calls, anybody from all over the world can call, and we get them from all over. And they ask questions. We have atheists call in and get angry and stuff like that. So that's what it's for. I want to be accessible, to be able to answer questions, because I'm going to defend the Bible view against all comers. Anyway, the skeptic on his website said, Hovind, don't you know that a Dutch astronomer named Jan Oort proposed, that means he hoped, he wished, he prayed, that there was a shell of comets out there at the remote frontiers of the solar system. He said the reason we still have comets is because new ones keep coming in from the Oort cloud. That's his theory, okay? He said this Oort cloud is 50,000 astronomical units away. Well, for those that don't know what an astronomical unit is, that is the distance from the Earth to the Sun. That is one astronomical unit, 93 million miles. Did you know it's pretty hard to see Pluto without an excellent telescope? And Pluto's only 39 astronomical units away. You certainly could not see a comet 50,000 astronomical units away. You see, nobody has ever seen the Oort cloud. Oort never saw the Oort cloud. The whole thing's based on a mathematical mistake. There is no Oort cloud. We got even guys like Carl Sagan, who said, many scientific papers are written each year about the Oort cloud, its properties, its origin, its evolution, yet there's not a shred of direct observational evidence for its existence. They know all about it, except they've never seen it and don't know anything about it. There is no Oort cloud. But this skeptic, Madsen, on his website said, fellas, if you want to use the comet argument, it's up to you to prove, beyond a reasonable doubt, that the Oort cloud and other sources don't exist. He's saying, I got to prove the Oort cloud doesn't exist. Now, just hold on a minute, Dave. That's not the way science works. What he's trying to do here is called shifting the burden of proof. The liberals are really good at doing that, and we fall for it most of the time. I'll show you how easy it is to shift the burden of proof. Suppose I said, watermelons are blue on the inside until you cut the skin. Prove I'm wrong. That'd be tough to do, wouldn't it? See, if all I have to do is make up a story and you got to prove it's wrong, I can keep you busy the rest of your life. And he's trying to make up a story that there's an Oort cloud and saying, I have to prove it doesn't exist. How on earth would you prove the non-existence of anything? Wouldn't you have to be all places at all times to prove anything doesn't exist? They can't find Osama bin Laden. Does that prove he doesn't exist? Duh. The Bible says the heavens declare the glory of God. Everything in the universe tells us God designed it. You know, the evolution theory has the sun and stars evolving before the earth. The Bible says he made the earth before the sun and stars. Very clearly different. Actually, there are many differences. Between the evolution theory and the creation theory, everything is backwards. It's opposite. And we got these Christians trying to blend the two together. I say, duh, you guys, your Bible says exactly the opposite of what the evolution theory says. You know, the Bible has the fish coming before the insects. Evolution has insects evolving before fish. The Bible has plants coming before the sun was made. Evolution has the sun coming and then the plants. Most important difference, number 11, the Bible says man brought death into the world. Evolution says death brought man into the world. Total opposite, folks. Somebody's wrong. There is no compromise in this battle. Somebody's wrong. People say, couldn't God use evolution to create? Well, it's not the God of the Bible. The God that would need to use an evolutionary process is cruel and wasteful and retarded. It's not the God the Bible teaches about. I wouldn't worship a God like that. Doesn't he know what he wants? Can't he just make it right in 6 days? Poof. Or 6 seconds. Why does your God have to practice and play around? You ought to trade your God in for a real one. The psalmist said, when I consider thy heavens. Hey, kids, he says when, not if. You would do yourself a favor to shut off that TV once in a while and go outside and consider what God has made. The psalmist said, while I was musing, the fire burned. The word muse is used twice in the Bible. It means to think. Think. Now, English is a pretty cool language. A theist is a person who believes in God. If you put the letter A in front of a word, it means the opposite of. So an atheist is a person who claims he does not believe in God. Okay? Muse means to think. Amuse literally means to not think. That is the meaning of the word. They've got entire parks where you can actually pay money and go do that. They're called amusement parks. That's exactly correct. Okay? The psalmist said, when I consider thy heavens, the work of thy fingers, the moon, the stars, which thou hast ordained, what is man that thou art mindful of him? You know, it's interesting. A person that spends his time considering what God has done is not impressed with what man can do. And parents, some of you ought to go home and look in your kid's bedroom. And if what you see plastered all over the wall are pictures of sports heroes, think carefully now. You're training your kids to meditate on what man can do. They're not meditating on what God has done. And you're going to raise a very shallow thinker in your house. The depth of his understanding is going to be, wow, he threw the ball through the hoop. Oh. And who is going to care in 40 years? Who's going to care in 5 years? Does anybody know who won the Super Bowl, 10 years ago? Anybody know who won 10 years ago? Does anybody care? It doesn't matter, does it? All those grown men out there fighting over that one ball, and they can all afford to go buy their own. I don't think it's sinful. I think it's just stupid to pay a guy $5 million to carry a pig bladder down a cow pasture. I don't think there's any common sense to that at all, okay? You ought to go outside and consider what God has made. You know, the most recent estimate is there's enough stars out there that everybody on planet Earth can own 11 trillion of them to yourself. 70 sextillion stars is the current estimate. Those are the ones we know about. We don't know about the ones that we don't know about. They asked the Hubble telescope to focus in on a dot. They thought they found a black spot in space, about the size of a grain of sand held at arm's length. The Hubble focused on that spot for 10 days, took a bunch of pictures. When they put them all together, they said, man, there are more stars there than we can count. These are ones we didn't know about before. Amazing universe God built. The Bible says, speak to the earth, and it shall teach thee. The earth is like a big magnet. Now, magnets always lose their strength. The earth's magnet has lost 10% of its strength in the last 150 years. Well, that's normal for magnets to lose their strength, but that's interesting. That proves the earth is not more than 25,000 years old. This is a limiting factor. Because if you go backwards in time, the magnetic field was stronger, and at some point it becomes too strong for life to exist here. Because of the heat generated, among other things. It also proves carbon dating can't work. Because carbon dating is directly proportional to the magnetic field. Because as the magnetic field declines, more radiation gets in, and that's what forms carbon-14. We cover more on that in video 7. But in 1949, when they first invented carbon dating, the leg of a mammoth dated 15,000 years old, but the skin from the same mammoth dated 21,000 years old. Didn't work. And it got worse as time went along. 1975, one part of a mammoth was 29,000 years old, another part's 44,000 from the same animal. Cover much more on video 7 about that, or on our website, drdino.com, if you want more on carbon dating. The textbook says, well, yes, Hovind, the magnetic field is declining, but that's because it's part of a pattern of reversals. It's getting ready to reverse. The magnetic field's declining, and it's going to flip over. Nobody has a clue how it even could reverse. There is no proof it ever has, and there are no magnetic reversals locked in the magnetic in the ocean floor. What we've observed for 150 years is the magnetic field is declining. That's observable science. The rest is purely theoretical. Actually, there's an interesting article in the beginning book, Walt Brown's book, about the magnetic reversal mythology here. It's a matter of stronger and weaker magnetism, not magnetic reversals. This is all part of another theory called Pangea. How many have ever heard of Pangea theory before? They say all the continents used to fit together. I get asked this question every week. Hey, Hovind, do you think all the continents used to fit together? I say, well, they didn't tell you they shrank Africa nearly 40% to make them fit, did they? I bet they didn't tell you they took out all of Mexico and Central America. Hey, señor, ¿qué pasa? ¿Dónde está Mexico, Panama, Costa Rica, Guatemala? And they also don't tell you what I think ought to be obvious to a kindergartner. Did you know if you take the water out of the oceans, there is dirt underneath? People say, do you think the continents were connected? I say, what do you mean were? They still are. Hello? It's not hollow under the oceans, you know. It's just the low places are full of water, that's all. Duh. We cover more on the Pangea theory on videotape number 6 of our series. What a dumb theory. The Earth is spinning about 1,000 miles an hour. 1,041.6 for you technical folks at the equator, but the Earth is slowing down. It actually is slowing down enough to create a problem. Every year to year and a half, they have to add a second to the clock because the Earth is slowing down. They call it a leap second. 1990, Pensacola News Journal said, we have to add a tick to the clock because Earth's rotation is slowing down. It says regular clocks use days as a measure, which are going longer by 1/1000th of a second or more daily as Earth's rotation slows. 1992, Astronomy Magazine said, Earth's rotation is slowing down. June will be 1 second longer than normal. We will have a leap second. Leap second. Did you know we have a leap second about every year to year and a half? Because the Earth is slowing down. Now, kids, this is going to be complicated, so listen carefully. The Earth is spinning, but it is slowing down. So that means that it used to be going faster. How many can figure this out now with no help? Okay. Well, now, if the Earth is only 6,000 years old, this is no problem. It was going a little faster when Adam was here. He wouldn't notice. He didn't have a watch anyway, as far as we know. But some of these guys want me to believe the Earth is billions of years old. Man, if you go back billions of years, the world was spinning real fast. Your days and nights would be pretty quick. Get up, go to bed, get up, go to bed, get up, go to bed. You never get nothing done. The centrifugal force would have been enormous. The winds would have been 5,000 miles an hour from the Coriolis effect. And you think dinosaurs lived 200 million years ago? Oh, I know what happened to them. They got blown off. No, they did not live 200 million years ago. The Sahara Desert has what's called a prevailing wind pattern. The wind almost always blows the same way. This creates a problem. The hot air blows off the desert and kills the trees next door, and that area becomes desert. The process is called desertification. Well, now, they've done quite a bit of study on Sahara. It's pretty obvious it is growing. There's just no question about that. But they said, after studying it for years, they said, you know, the Sahara Desert's probably about 4,000 years old. Okay, I have no reason to doubt that, but I do have a question. If the Sahara is only 4,000 years old, why don't we have a bigger desert someplace? Why would the biggest desert on Earth be less than 4,000 years old? Well, I have a theory about that. Now, here's my theory. I believe about 6,000 years ago, God created everything. 4,400 years ago, there was a flood. It's pretty hard to have a desert under a flood. Right? So the desert couldn't start growing until the flood water went down. So I predict, based on the Bible, the biggest desert in the world will be less than 4,400 years old. It is. Wow. Maybe the Bible's right. Did you know when they drill into the ground, sometimes they hit oil? The oil's oftentimes under incredible pressure, like 20,000 pounds per square inch. It'll come squirting up out of the ground, poof, like a big zit, 20,000 PSI. Well, the guys who study this problem say, you know, the oil has some pressure simply because of the rocks on top of it. It's called the overlying weight of the rock, the overburden. That produces pressure. But the oil pressure is greater than the weight of overbearing rock. So this should have cracked the rock and equalized the pressure in less than 10,000 years. Okay, well, if all that's true, then I have a question. Why do we still have oil pressure? Actually, where did the oil come from? Well, most scientists agree, and I agree with them, that oil comes from organisms that are squished. They're changed by heat and pressure into oil. Clear back in 1970, they learned how to make oil in 30 minutes, 20 or 30 minutes in the laboratory. In 1996, they set up a factory in Australia to turn sewage sludge into oil in 30 minutes. They opened up a factory in Texas a couple years ago, can turn almost anything to oil. They're taking turkey guts and turning it into oil with heat and pressure. Check it out, Discover Magazine, May of 2003. Sinclair Gas Company has the dinosaur as their logo. They say dinosaurs turn to oil. Yes, boys and girls, these dinosaurs mellowed for 80 million years. I don't think so. I have a theory about the oil. Here's my theory. I believe about 6,000 years ago, God made everything. 4,400 years ago, there was a flood. In that flood, lots of critters and people drowned. And they got covered up by the gravel and the rocks and the mud and the sand, and it got pretty heavy after a while, and it squished them into oil. So the oil's down there today from the people and animals that drowned in that flood. Which means if you stop and think about that, you drove over here today on some of your ancestors. Next time you're pumping them in there, you can say, bye, Grandpa. You should have listened to Noah. He told you it was going to rain. You should have got on that boat. Yeah. I was preaching in Denver, Colorado one time, and some guys came to the meeting, and they said, Hovind, can we talk to you for a minute? I said, sure. After the meeting, we talked, and they said, now look, you know, we know that you go around teaching the earth is 6,000 years old. We'd like to prove you're wrong. Would you come with us, please? I said, sure. These guys worked at the National Ice Core Laboratory just outside of Denver. They said, we go to Greenland and to the South Pole, and we drill holes through the ice. Government job, you know. And we save the center part of the hole. Oh, we need more ice, that's for sure. We're running out of ice. Spend $1 billion, go to Greenland and get some. Well, they drill these holes down in the ice. They take what's called a core sample. Here's a picture of the coring machine. This thing drills down and snaps off a 6 to 10 foot section of ice and pulls it up out of the hole. And they said, we want to show you these ice cores, Mr. Hovind. Come on in the freezer. They took me in this massive freezer they've got there, about as big as this auditorium, 36 below zero in there. And they took these ice cores out of their styrofoam tubes and laid one on the table and said, now see this ice core here? I said, yep. They said, you see the rings on there? It looks like tree rings, dark and light and dark and light. I said, oh yeah, they're very clear. Interesting. They said, now Hovind, in the summer, the snow melts just a little bit on top and then it refreezes and makes clear ice, which shows up dark here on the picture. In the winter, it packs the snow and it makes white ice. So what we have here are examples of summer, winter, summer, winter, summer, winter, summer, winter, just like annual rings of a tree. I said, okay. They said, now the deepest hole we ever drilled is 10,000 feet. And we counted 135,000 annual rings. And here you are claiming the earth is 6,000 years old. Hovind, you're wrong. I said, now fellas, aren't you assuming those are annual rings? See, apparently they didn't know about the Lost Squadron, but some airplanes ran out of gas during World War II and landed in Greenland. How many have ever heard of the Lost Squadron? It's been on TV a couple times. Go to thelostsquadron.com and see all about it. Well, a rich man from Kentucky got a brilliant idea to go over there and get those airplanes off the ice. Brand new World War II airplanes sitting there on the ice. He said, hey, let's brush off the snow, gas them up, and fly them home. Well, it wasn't quite that easy. They had to find them using ground-penetrating radar because the airplanes were under 263 feet of ice in 48 years. They melted a hole down to get to one of them, a P-38, and took it apart and brought all the pieces up through the hole. They call it cold mining with a hot tube they ran water through called the gopher. They melted a hole down there, took the airplane apart, brought the pieces up through the hole, and put it back together in Middleboro, Kentucky. It flew a couple years ago for the first time in nearly 50 years. Now, when they melted down to get to the airplane, they went through ice rings. Interesting. Airplanes are in the ground for 48 years. They were 263 feet down. Those are historical scientific facts, okay? That's 5.5 feet a year worth of ice accumulating on top of those planes. You had 10,000 feet is the deepest hole they ever drilled. You divide that by 5.5 and you get 1,800 years, not 135,000. Now, deeper layers get squished, I understand. The pressure changes it to FIRN, F-I-R-N. I understand that. I taught her science for years. So really, 4,400 is no problem. 4,400 years is no problem to account for all the ice at the North and South Pole. Well, I went up and visited the airport where they're putting this thing together. I got to talk to the guy who helped dig it out. His name is Bob Carden. There's his picture and his phone number right there. Call him if you don't believe me. I said, Bob, when you melted down to get to that airplane, did you go through ice rings? He said, oh, yes, many hundreds of them. I said, how could there be hundreds of annual rings in 48 years? Shouldn't there be like maybe, you know, 48? He said, annual rings? He said, those aren't annual rings. He said, that doesn't represent summer, winter, summer, winter. It represents warm, cold, warm, cold, warm, cold. You can get five of those in 1 week around here, can't you? Yeah. But here's a Scientific American article where the guy is still calling them annual layers. Now, folks, either he's confused or he's under-informed of the topic or he's deliberately lying. He may just be ignorant, okay? I hope that's the case because ignorance can be fixed. Stupid is forever, but ignorance can be fixed, all right? That's the difference, by the way. A guy that works with the Eskimos sent me this postcard and said, Brother Hovind, I work with the Eskimos in Alaska. He said they've got over 40 words for snow up here, different types of snow. He said, I got 15 layers of snow on my car in 8 hours. Not 15 inches, 15 layers of snow. Those layers are not different ages, not a year apart. Same thing with the textbook when they tell the kids about the Cenozoic, Mesozoic, Paleozoic. How many have ever heard of the geologic column before? We cover much more on that on video 4. The geologic column is a joke. It doesn't exist any place on planet Earth except in the textbooks. Get our video number 4 for more on that. Those layers are not different ages. All over the world, petrified trees have been found standing up, connecting these layers. Now, they're telling us these layers are different ages, and yet we've got petrified trees connecting them. I'm sorry, you're mistaken. The layers are not different ages. They all formed in one flood, and it doesn't take long for things to petrify. Things can petrify quickly. Here's a piece of petrified firewood. I've got a petrified pickle in my museum in Pensacola. The lid to the jar rusted off and the pickle turned to stone inside the jar. We got the jar and the pickle. Come on up and see it. One kid sent me a bag of petrified acorns with a little note. He said, Brother Hovind, I put these acorns in the water to hope they would sprout, and I forgot about them. 10 years old, you know. Next spring, my mom found the bucket on the back porch and said, Son, get rid of these acorns. He said, in less than a year, they turned to stone. I've got them in the museum. Stop and see our dinosaur adventure land in Pensacola, Florida. Here's a petrified fish giving birth. It doesn't take millions of years to give birth, praise God, okay? There's a petrified cowboy boot with the cowboy's legs still in it. It's on the table now. There's an article about it. It's called The Limestone Cowboy. Mm-hmm. Anyway, we cover more on that on videotape number 6 about petrification. The Mississippi River is depositing sediments at the rate of 80,000 tons every hour. 80,000 tons of mud comes down the Mississippi and dumps off in New Orleans. That delta is growing larger and larger and larger. There's no question there's a lot of mud coming down that river. They call it the Muddy Mississippi. And there's no question the delta is growing. But it's interesting. After studying the delta carefully, they've drilled holes all over that thing looking for oil under it, you know. Their current estimate is that the delta has about 30,000 years worth of mud out there. Okay. Well, then I have a question. If the Earth is millions of years old, why isn't the whole Gulf of Mexico full of mud by now? They're going to say, hey, Hovind, it's 30,000 years. That proves your Bible's wrong. Your Bible says 6,000. Well, no, I got a theory about that delta. Now, here's my theory. I believe about 6,000 years ago, God created everything. 4,400 years ago, there was a flood. And as the flood water was running off, about half of that mud went out there in 20 minutes. So it looks like it took 30,000 years. They forgot the flood. That'll mess them up every time. A friend of mine from Louisiana is pastor of a church now, but he said, Brother Hovind, I used to drill for oil in the Gulf of Mexico. He said, we drilled through 14,000 feet of mud and hit trees 60 feet tall, under 14,000 feet of mud. Folks, most of that mud was washed out in a big catastrophe called the flood. Here's a picture of the oldest tree in the world. The oldest living tree is a bristlecone pine in Southern California. Estimates of the age of the tree vary from 4,300 to 4,700. This textbook says 4,300 years old is the oldest organism. Now, the fact is, trees don't always produce one ring a year. They can produce two rings a year. Okay? One guy said in a seminar, I had a Q&A session, he said, Mr. Hovind, you're exactly right. He said, I'm a professional wood carver. I've done it for 40 years. He said, I plant my own trees and carve and make walking sticks for people, expensive walking sticks, you know, for rich people who can pay $1,000 for one or whatever. He said, we grow our trees for 7 years, cut them down. They always have at least 11 rings in 7 years. That's what he told me. He said, I've been doing it for 40 years. Anyway, this textbook says the oldest tree is 4,300 years old. Now, that's interesting. I have a question. If the earth is billions of years old, why don't we have an older tree someplace? Why would the oldest tree on earth be 4,300 years old? Well, I have a theory about that. Here's my theory. I believe 6,000 years ago, God created everything. 4,400 years ago, there was a flood. Wrecked everything. So the oldest tree ought to be less than 4,400 years old. Amen, it is. Here's a picture of a coral reef. You know, the largest reef in the world is off the coast of Australia. It's called the Great Barrier Reef. I had a call from a church in Brisbane. They said, do you want to come preach over here? I said, I need to pray about this. He said, yes. I took my whole family to Australia. My daughter and I got to go scuba diving at the Great Barrier Reef. It was incredible. During World War II, some of the reef was destroyed by ships and anchors and bombs and stuff like that. So the environmentalist wackos went out there to see how fast it grows back. They watched the reef grow for 20 years. It was a government project. Based on a 20-year study, they said the reef is less than 4,200 years old. Oh, okay. Well, then I have a question. If the earth is millions of years old, why don't we have a bigger reef someplace? Why would the biggest reef on earth be less than 4,200 years old? I have a theory about that. I bet you know what it is, don't you? You can figure it out. Okay. Here's a picture of Niagara Falls. The textbook says, boys and girls, the rocky ledge above Niagara Falls has been eroding for 9,900 years. Now, how do they know that? Well, it's pretty interesting. The rocks are breaking off the edge. All waterfalls do that, you know. The water rocks break off the edge, and the waterfall eats its way backwards. The water flows one way, the waterfall moves the other way in response to the erosion. They've studied Niagara Falls pretty carefully for the last 200 years. They say it's moving back 4.7 feet a year. Interesting. Well, when Charlie Lyell went there in 1840, he said Niagara Falls is obviously back here, and it quite obviously started up here by Lewiston, New York. It's moving back down the gully. Charlie Lyell said, I think it took 10,000 years to go that far. Now, he said that purposely to try to discredit the Bible. Charlie Lyell hated the Bible. And that's the book that destroyed the faith of Charles Darwin. We get into more of that on videotape number 4. But Lyell, the people, he said it took 10,000 years. The people that lived there said, hey, it erodes much faster than that. But he didn't listen to them. He had his theory. He had his agenda to push, okay? He wanted to discredit the scriptures. Now, the fact is, the water goes over the falls into a gorge called the Niagara Gorge. I was just there a couple of weeks ago. That gorge is 7.5 miles long. All right, this textbook says a simple calculation shows it's been 9,900 years worth of erosion. Well, it's not quite that simple, okay? You see, Niagara Falls is right here. It used to be further north by Lewiston. It's moving south, quite obviously, because the water flows north. I got a question now. If the earth is millions of years old, why hasn't it eroded all the way back to Lake Erie? Why is Niagara Falls right there? Well, I have a theory about that. Here's my theory. I believe about 6,000 years ago, God created everything. 4,400 years ago, there was a flood. As the flood water was running off, about half of that gully washed out in 20 minutes. So it looks like it took 9,900 years by the textbook. No, they forgot the flood. They also forgot to get the right numbers, okay? See, if they had divided right, it would have been 8,400 using the 4.7. But, you know, public school textbook, what do you expect? Okay. When it rains, 30% of the water runs into the ocean. The rest evaporates or soaks into the ground. Well, as it runs into the ocean, it brings with it mineral salts off the ground. It washes salts off the ground called mineral salts. The oceans are getting saltier every day because of the distillation process of sunlight evaporating water out and, you know, minerals washing in and water coming out. The minerals don't come out, just the water. Today, the oceans are 3.6% salt. They could have done that in less than 5,000 years. I was in a debate one time, and this atheist said, "Hovind, would you please tell me how the freshwater fish survived Noah's flood?" I said, "Well, sir, aren't you assuming the flood was salt water?" He said, "The ocean is salt water." I said, "Well, yeah, it is today. I think during the flood, it's probably mostly fresh water." He said, "Well, how did the saltwater fish survive?" I said, "Well, there probably weren't any." He said, "The ocean is full of saltwater creatures." I said, "Well, yeah, it is today." I said, "I think what happened over the last 4,400 years, some animals have gradually become adapted to saltwater. And today we have freshwater alligators and freshwater crocodiles and saltwater crocodiles. And they probably had a common ancestor, a crocodile." He said, "That's evolution." I said, "Oh, it is not. Going from a freshwater croc to a saltwater croc is a minor change compared to what you believe. So you believe they changed from a rock to a croc. Now, there's a major change for you folks." Yes, sir. How many of you have ever gone into a cave and the guide said, "Don't touch the formations. They take millions of years to form"? They all have the same story, right? You go to Carlsbad, they'll say, "Yep, it took 250 million years to make these formations in here." They say tiny drops of water slowly build these formations. One guy said it takes 1,000 years to grow from 1/10 of a centimeter to 10 centimeters, up to 2.5 inches. Maximum be 2.5 inches per 1,000 years. Well, I don't think so. Here are some 50-inch long stalactites growing under the Lincoln Memorial, built 1922. Here's a bat covered up with flowstone before it could rot. It doesn't take millions of years for that stuff to form. Here's 2-inch stalactites growing off a refrigeration shed in Pensacola, Florida. There's a building in Indiana. It's only 40 years old. The basement is full of huge flowstone formations in 40 years from water dripping through the limestone. Here's a mine in Australia that was closed down for 55 years. When they opened it up to just check to see how it's doing, there were huge cave formations that formed in 55 years. There are two people inside that circle to give you an idea how big this is. Here's a pipe that was dripping water up at Herbert Field near Pensacola at Eglin Air Force Base. Made a 13-inch stalactite in 7 years. Underneath, on the ground, was a stalagmite. Everybody kept tripping on it, and so they broke it off and gave it to me. It's in my museum. Stalagmite formed in 7 years. Here's a parking garage in Texas. Brand new parking garage, built in 1997. It was making stalagmites on students' cars parking under it, so they put up a drip pan to catch the water. A guy in Wyoming had a hot mineral spring on his property in Thermopolis, Wyoming, and so he stuck a pipe in the ground back in 1903. The water came out the top of the pipe, ran down the sides. They called it the teepee fountain, kind of a natural fountain. Everybody thought, "Wow, that's cute. He's got a fountain in his yard." Well, slowly over the years, the water, as it ran down the side of the pipe, evaporated, some of it, leaving behind mineral deposits. How many have seen those mineral deposits in your sink, okay? Well, the guy died, and they left the pipe sticking in the yard. It's now been there for 100 years. Here it is, about 6 years ago. That would take some lime away to scrub that clean, don't you think? Sure would. It does not take millions of years to form those things. That's 100 years worth. The guy down the street started one later. It's not quite as big. But folks, it doesn't take a long time. Did you know at the current rate of erosion, the continents are going to erode flat in 14 million years? We have mudslides, landslides, of course, erosion, abrasion, exfoliation. Does the ground ever fall up? It's always down, isn't it? Sedimentary rocks always on its way down anyway. You might get igneous rock coming up, volcanoes. But you know, they're telling us we got fossils in sedimentary rock that are 300 times older than the current erosion rate would allow for. All you got to do is fly out west. 2 days ago, I flew back from Grand Canyon, flew out west. You just look out the window of the plane, folks. It looks like there's erosion marks every place down there in places that hardly ever rain. We cover Grand Canyon in video 4 also. If you think that river made that canyon, you need to watch video number 4. Erosion marks all over this world are evidence of massive flooding on this planet. And we could spend all day on that. We cover more in video 6. A couple more things and we'll quit. The oldest writings in the world are about 5,000 years old. Well, that's interesting. Why would the oldest writings be 5,000 years old? Why does a Chinese calendar say this is the year 4704 right now? They think they started with Noah. The Chinese calendar, or the Hebrew calendar, said this is the year 5764. They think they started with Adam with their calendar. Don't trust the Egyptian calendar, by the way. That one's greatly exaggerated. Get the book Evolution Cruncher, a 900-page book for $5. Go to our website. It's a great book with lots of good stuff on evolution. Why would the oldest reliable historical records be less than 6,000 years old? I have a theory about that. I think the Bible is absolutely correct. I think the evidence for a young earth is overwhelming. The evidence for an old earth is minimal. And like the coins in the box, you have to go by the limiting factors. Each one of the evidences for a young earth would have to be overcome. Each single one would stand independently. Students are never shown the idea, though, that the earth might be young. I think I know why. This isn't really a science book anymore. It's a book about evolution. Somebody wants to make sure your kids believe that theory because it's part of a much bigger long-range plan toward a new world order. There's a reason for this. The founding fathers who started this country said, "We hold these truths to be self-evident. All men are created equal. They're endowed by their creator with certain rights." Where do rights come from? Well, they come from the creator. And if you get a bunch of people together who believe they have rights that come from the creator, those people do not make good slaves. They will actually throw the tea in the harbor and start a big war. They will. Now, if you want to have a one-world government, a new world order like some of these lunatics would like to have, and like is prophesied in the Bible, they're going to get it. You can't have people believing in creation. So they've been working really hard for the last 100 years to take over the school system where they only teach this evolution theory, which says rights come from government. Rights don't come from the creator because there is no creator. It ties into many things. We cover more on that on video 5. For example, do you have the right to have a church? The government says in the Internal Revenue Code 501c3 that you can ask to be an exemption to the tax laws if you'd like. And most churches do that. They file papers to become a corporation, which is a creature of the state, and then they become 501c3 exempt. But they admitted a couple pages later in Internal Revenue Code 508 that churches are an exception. Why would you give up an exception status to become an exemption? Think about it. There's more on that on the website hushmoney.org. Same thing with marriage. Why do you ask the state for permission to get married? Who gives the right to get married? That's another long story. We cover that in our college class. But did you know 75% of the kids that go to public schools are going to lose their faith after 1 year of college? 75%. That's what happened to Crawford Toy. Most of you have probably never heard of Crawford Toy. Crawford Toy was a brilliant Bible scholar. He worked with the Southern Baptist Convention in the late 1800s. He loved the Lord and loved the Bible. He was a professor at the Southern Baptist Seminary. You might know about the girl he almost married. He just about married a girl named Lottie Moon. How many have ever heard of Lottie Moon before? Every year the Southern Baptists have the Lottie Moon offering. Well, Crawford went to Europe and studied evolution after the Civil War. He came back convinced the theory was true. He told his class, he said, "The Bible intends to teach a plain six-day creation. The Bible is simply in error at that point." The Bible's in error? Crawford, maybe your theory's in error. Maybe you have been brainwashed. Folks, it is very easy to get brainwashed. I'm going to try to brainwash the entire crowd here tonight. And then we're going to quit, take some break, and have some question and answer time. I'm going to tell you a little story. As I tell the story, I will brainwash you. Maybe you've never been brainwashed before. It's okay. It's a harmless procedure, right? When I'm done brainwashing you, I will ask you two questions about the story. If you know the answer, it's probably because you saw my video before. If you don't know the answer, it's because you were successfully brainwashed. Now, pay attention, watch carefully. Here goes the story. Once upon a time, a man left home jogging. He jogged a little ways and turned left. He jogged a little ways and turned left. He jogged a little ways and turned left and jogged back home. As he was jogging home, he noticed two masked men waiting for him at home. Who were the masked men, and why did he leave home jogging? If you know for sure, don't say it out loud, just raise your hand. 6, 7, 8, about 12, okay? The rest of you, pay attention. Let's try it again. Once upon a time, a man left home jogging. He jogged a little ways and turned left. I'll give you a hint, that's important. He jogged a little ways and turned left. He jogged a little ways, turned left, and jogged back home. As he was jogging home, he noticed two masked men waiting for him at home. Who were the masked men, and why did he leave home jogging? Anybody new figure it out? Four more. Okay, the rest of you, pay attention. We're going to try it again. Now, I'm going to unbrainwash you. Now, watch carefully. I'll tell the same story, and you'll feel yourself get unbrainwashed in a few seconds. Once upon a time, a man left home jogging. He jogged a little ways and turned left. He jogged a little ways and turned left. He jogged a little ways, turned left, and jogged back home. As he was jogging home, he noticed two masked men were waiting for him at home. Who were the masked men, and why did he leave home jogging? The catcher and the umpire, and he hit a home run. You say, Brother Hovind, is it that easy to get brainwashed? Yep. You see, as soon as I said a man left home, you started thinking about a house, right? And for the rest of the story, you could not figure out who those two masked men were. If you get somebody off track in the first few seconds, it's real tough to get back on track. Would you like to see how thousands of kids get brainwashed in Duval County every year? Thousands of them. Right here in the middle of the Bible Belt. The kid goes to kindergarten. Maybe some kid out of your house, maybe one of your children, goes to kindergarten, and he gets a book like this. I can read about dinosaurs. Would anybody like to just take a wild guess at what the first sentence in the book says? Millions of years ago. Do you think there's any books like this in your school system? Do you think there's any books like this in your public library? You think the kids are going to hear this stuff on Nature Channel, Steve Irwin, Crocodile Hunter, Discovery Channel, National Geographic? Of course they are. Dr. Seuss, millions of years before you were born. It's everywhere, folks. I go to museums all the time. I am sick and tired of all the museums teaching evolution. So we started our own, a creation museum. Come visit Pensacola, Florida. When they say the earth is millions of years old, that's calling Jesus a liar. Jesus said the creation of Adam was the beginning. Do you realize we got Christians that teach their kids we have death in the world because of man's sin? And then they read them a story about dinosaurs dying before man got here. Hello? Have you thought about the inconsistency in your logic? Well, we cover more on that in other series, seminar series, but the Bible says they lived to be 900 years old before the flood. How's that possible? Well, we cover that on video number 2. How on earth did they live to be 900? What was that Garden of Eden like? What was it like before the flood? We cover that on seminar part 2. And you can watch our seminars right online. And what about dinosaurs? Didn't dinosaurs live millions of years ago? No. Dinosaurs lived with Adam and Eve. We cover that on video number 3, all about dinosaurs. But listen, somebody's going to teach your kids. You started like a slime and you slowly evolved to a human. That teaching is going to destroy their whole philosophy of life. The Bible says, beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men and the rudiments of the world and not after Christ. If a kid goes 12 to 16 years to school in your school system, how's he going to view the world? Now look, I'm not against schools, I'm not against teachers. My brother led me to the Lord. He's been a public school teacher for 34 years. My mom was a public school teacher and retired years ago. She's been in heaven for 10 years now. I'm not against the schools, I'm not against teachers, but folks, the books teach something that's going to destroy your kids' philosophy. The Bible says, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. He says He did it in 6 days. You know, if the Bible's right about the beginning, maybe it's right about the end also. Let's summarize here and we'll quit. God made this world. He owns it. He makes the rules. And every one of us is guilty of breaking His rules. He told us pretty clearly in the Ten Commandments, thou shalt not bear false witness. Don't tell a lie. How many of you have ever told a lie in your life? Come on, put your hand up. You're doing another one. I don't want to hear this pious, not me. Okay? Bible says, thou shalt not steal. How many ever stole something? Come on, you already told me you're a liar. Put your hand up, okay? All right, so far we know we're all a bunch of lying thieves, right? Do you want to read the whole list and see how See how we're doing? We're 0 for 2 so far. We better stop right there. There is no question on Judgment Day, when Judgment Day comes, we are going to be found guilty. No question. Which means we're going to be punished. Or you better find a substitute. And that's where Jesus comes in. Praise God. Jesus has volunteered to pay for your sins. Not because you're good, but because you need it. You're bad, okay? But He loves you. He wants to forgive you. These deer figured out if they get in the river, the fire goes right past them. It's pretty smart thinking. Hey, did you know if you're in Christ, the judgment's going to go right past you? I deserve God's judgment, but I'm not going to get it. I'm in Christ. That's amazing. What if some of these idiots do reduce the population of the planet? What if we're all dead this year? You're going to die someday. Where are you going to go? If you died today, where would you go? That's an important question because you're going to be dead for a really long time. I don't care how long you live, you will be dead longer than that. George Washington died 205 years ago and he is still dead. Where are you going when you die? All you get is that little tiny dash between two dates. Someday there's going to be a rock with your name on it. Could be this week. You could die tonight. Have you seen the way they drive out here? Got some rednecks on the highway, folks, I'm telling you what. You can get killed this evening. I'm going to die someday. I'm going to try to make it the last thing I do, but it's going to happen. It's going to happen to you too, okay? Where are you going? You're going to be there for a long time. If you're not sure you're saved, what you need to do is very simple. You need to say, Lord, I confess I have sinned. I have broken your laws. I'm guilty. Don't go before God and say, hey, I'm pretty good. You better take me. He's not impressed, okay? You're lying. You're not very good. Admit it. Lord, I'm a sinner. And Lord, I have violated your laws. I have broken your laws. I'm guilty. But Lord, I believe that you died to pay for my sins. And Lord, right now, I'd like to pray and ask you to forgive me and save me. And then just say, Jesus, forgive me. Come live in my heart. Save me. That's what I did 35 years ago, tomorrow, my spiritual birthday. I said, Lord, forgive me. Please save me. He actually moved in, started making a brand new person out of me, started working on things. Boy, when he moved in, he had a long list of things to work on. He still got a few. I won't tell you what they are, but okay. At least he's in there working. Would you like to get Jesus in your life and get him to start working on making you a brand new person? Just invite him in. Ask him to save you. And then write this date down and say, today's my spiritual birthday into God's family. And give us a call. We'll be glad to rejoice with you if you did that. We got a book we send out to folks who ask Christ to save them through our video series called The Next Step. What do I do now? Okay? Here's the next step, how to get involved, get busy, how to grow. So, Wayne Strickland picked out his tombstone. Wayne Strickland, atheist, he says. That's brilliant. The Bible says the fool has said in his heart, there is no God. Did you know God does not believe in atheists? Ray Comfort's a good friend of mine. He's got a school called The Way of the Master. If you want to learn to be a better soul winner, get on my website, drdino.com, and click the button, The Way of the Master, and get his course on how to be a better soul winner. Listen, God is not willing that any should perish. It doesn't matter what you've done, His blood can cleanse you from all iniquity. He can save you. If you're a Christian, then what on earth are you doing, for heaven's sake? Everybody ought to find something to do for the Lord. Witness to somebody. You know, give them a gospel tract. You say, I don't want to drive them off. What are you going to drive them off to? Hell number two? I mean, come on. Find something to do for the Lord with your life. What on earth are you doing, for heaven's sake? If we can help, our material is there to help you. We've got materials on the table over there. Get one of our catalogs. We have videos just on debates I've done at universities, topical series, other stuff, not creation. And then the blue series is all about creation. The seminar you heard tonight is seminar part 1B about creation. There's a whole lot more on there. Our material is not copyrighted. Feel free to copy it and give it to your friends. As long as you're not selling it, just copy it and give it away. Use it as a witnessing tool. We have lots of material. Our Dr. Kaboom Kabang series, a lot of homeschool materials, college classes. Go to the website, drdino.com, and feel free to call us if we can help. If you're not a Christian, that's most important. You need to come and let somebody take a Bible tonight, take you off where it's quiet someplace, and explain to you from that book how you can have your sins forgiven. If you are a Christian, maybe you need to hit the altar and say, Lord, I'm not doing much for you. Forgive me. Show me what you want to do. Get me busy in your service. Let's all stand, bow our heads and close our eyes. We'll pray, and then we'll take a break, and then we'll have Q&A time after this for those that want to stay. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for loving us. Lord, thank you for all these people coming out. I pray that our faith in your word will be strengthened as a result of these things we've heard tonight. Lord, there might be some people here that are not saved. If they die on the way home tonight, or if they die tomorrow, or if they die 100 years from now, they're going to hell. Lord, I know you don't want that, but I know you are angry with the wicked every day, and you certainly will judge their sin, no question. You offered an escape through Jesus, and if they don't want it, then they'll pay for their own sin. Lord, please help them to come and let somebody take a Bible and show them how to be saved tonight. And Lord, there might be some of your children here. They're saved, but they're wasting their life on things that are all going to burn. They're going to work for a big house, big boat, big car, and it's all going to burn. They're going to leave it all behind. Oh, Father, help them to invest their life in something of eternal value in Jesus' name. Amen. We hope you've enjoyed this video series on creation, evolution, and dinosaurs. Much more important, though, than knowing all the truth and facts about science is to know the truth about whether you're going to heaven or not. If you've never trusted Christ as your Savior, let me explain quickly what you need to do to go to heaven. The Bible says we're all sinners. We've all broken God's laws. We've disobeyed the Creator. We've done wicked things. We're sinners. Some are worse than others, at least in man's eyes, but we've all broken God's laws. And the Bible says you have to repent. The word repent means to turn. It actually means two things, to turn from your sin and to turn to God. God's looking for a change in your attitude where you say, Lord, I don't want to do wrong anymore. I'm sorry, I've offended you. I want to do right. And you turn from sin and you turn to God and say, God, would you please forgive me? Would you save me? The Bible says in Romans chapter 3, verse 23, that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. You need to admit you're a sinner. Number two, the Bible says in Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death. We deserve to die and go to hell because of our sin. But Jesus died for you. He loves you. He wants you to come to heaven. And anybody that will ask Him for the free salvation, God will give you the gift of eternal life, it says in Romans 6:23. It's a free gift. And it says in Romans chapter 10 and verse 13, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. If you would just call and say, Lord, I'm a sinner, would you please forgive me? And ask Him. He will give you that free gift of eternal life. Why don't you just pray with me right now and you could receive Christ as your Savior. There's no magic words. God's looking at your heart. But if you could say this and mean it, God would forgive you. Just say, Dear Lord Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner. I've broken your laws. I'm sorry. Please forgive me. Please apply your blood to my account. Forgive my sins and take me to heaven. In Jesus' name, amen. The Bible says, if you call upon the Lord, you shall be saved. So if you've asked the Lord to save you, He promised He'd save you. Now your job is to grow. Read your Bible, pray, get involved in a good Bible-believing church, and begin to grow to be a good Christian. Thank you so much. Call or write if we can be any help at all. We'd be glad to help.
Do you want to know more about how to combat the godless theory of evolution? Creation Science Evangelism offers four great tools that help strengthen the faith of believers and win the lost to Christ. After 15 years of teaching high school science, Dr. Hoven began Creation Science Evangelism in 1989. We are a ministry that is dedicated to providing tools which will help you combat the evolution philosophy that is destroying the faith of millions every year. The first tool Creation Science offers is their powerful, life-changing video series. Over the last 12 years, well over a million videotapes of Dr. Hoven's seminar have circled the globe. They are reaping a harvest of souls for the kingdom of Christ, as well as helping restore the faith of many thousands confused by the evolution propaganda to which they've been subjected. These videos are available in English, Russian, French, Spanish, Japanese, and sign language. The Age of the Earth, first of the seven-part series, teaches that God created the universe about 6,000 years ago in six literal days. Could this be true? Can it be scientifically proven that the Earth is not billions of years old? This tape gives solid scientific evidence that the Earth is young and that the Bible is scientifically accurate. How did the environment of the original creation differ from ours today? And how would this allow men to live over 900 years? Can Christians have a good explanation for the existence of dinosaurs? Could some dinosaurs still be alive today? These and many more questions are covered in the second and third part of the series. Evolution has permeated public school textbooks with false and fraudulent information. This video exposes nearly 30 lies commonly found in textbooks. Every public school student, teacher, and school board member needs to watch part 4 of this series. Find out if you have been lied to in your textbooks. Discover the terrible difference evolutionary beliefs have made in the past as well as in recent history in our video number 5. Dictators throughout time have used their evolution-based philosophies to rationalize their brutal actions. Learn how evolution propaganda is being used today to prepare people for the New World Order. This is just a taste of all the information the 17-hour seminar series has to offer. Also available are college courses that expand on the seminars in great detail. For those who can handle a more confrontational atmosphere, our debate series is just for you.
I said, now, Mr. Patterson, if you think the tailbone is vestigial, I, Kent Hovind, will pay to have yours removed.
Dr. Hovind has debated a wide range of atheists and evolutionists all over the country. And you're sure to find these 12 debates very exciting. These would be perfect to present to that scientifically minded person who likes to argue their point. Our topical series includes exciting topics like why evolution is stupid, public school presentation, children's video about dinosaurs, the Bible and health, Leviathan, the fire-breathing dragon, and many more. Creation Science also offers a variety of visuals, like the longevity chart, which presents the entire lineage of Adam to Joseph as given in Genesis. It's exciting to see exactly how many generations were alive at the same time. Hundreds of books on a variety of subjects, videos on incredible creatures that defy evolution, t-shirts, fossils, and more. Make Creation Science Evangelism the one-stop shopping center for your creation material needs. Our two websites, www.drdino.com and www.dinosauradventureland.com, provide our second tool for evangelism. DrDino.com is packed with lots of information, from charts and graphs to articles and frequently asked questions. This is also where you will find more information on all of the products CSE has to offer. DinosaurAdventureland.com is great for the kids. They can play lots of fun games and see unusual rides and activities located at Dinosaur Adventureland in Pensacola, Florida. Thousands visit our sites regularly to gain insight into God's creation. The third tool available to you is the live seminars conducted by Dr. Hovind and his son Eric. Since 1989, Dr. Hovind has held seminars and debates in hundreds of churches, schools, and universities in 49 states and 30 foreign countries. His fast-paced, illustrated seminars cover diverse topics, such as evidence for a young Earth, how long Adam lived, dinosaurs living with man, where races came from, radiometric dating, and much more. Our fourth tool is the new, exciting Dinosaur Adventureland. Many thousands have come from all across America to visit our museum, creation bookstore, science center, and theme park, where God gets the glory for science. Our unusual swings, rides, and activities each have a science lesson as well as a spiritual lesson. Captivate everyone from age 4 to 94. To order material, find out how to schedule a seminar at your church, or get more information about Dinosaur Adventureland, write to us at Creation Science Evangelism, 29 Cummings Road, Pensacola, Florida, 32503. Or call us at 850-479-3466. Or toll free in the U.S., 877-479-3466.